वेलकम प्राची।
फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी हैव विद अस सीए प्राची पारेख। शी विल बी टेकिंग द टॉपिक ऑफ टीडीएस एंड टीसीएस प्रोविजंस। एज वी ऑल आर फेसिंग दिस टाइम द चेंजेस व्हिच वी हैव केम अक्रॉस इन टीडीएस एंड टीसीएस प्रोविजन। So to start with, I just request a core committee member Himanshu Bhai take the introduction of this particular.
Himanshu Bhai, thank you Alpesh. It's my pleasure in introducing to you all today's speaker, CA Prachi Parekh. She is young, passionate, down to earth, and energetic. Her professional qualifications are qualified chartered accountant in year 2009, law graduate in 2019. She is engaged in taxation, advisory service and research, technical support to professionals. She is freelancing with CNK and Associates LLC, formerly known as Contractor Nayak and Krishnadwala, as knowledge manager handling technical content. She believes in the philosophy that sharing the knowledge is enhancing the knowledge. Ex-faculty with MT Educare for Direct Tax. Freelancer faculty with WRC, ICI, JK Shah classes for direct taxes, regular speaker at various CP study circles, contributory to BCA journal, BCA chambers journal. With this short introduction, I am welcoming Prachi Parekh and request her to take forward. Thank you, Prachi.
Thank you. Thank you, Himanshu Bhai. Before starting the session, a request to the members who has paid excess fees during the year to kindly fill up the refund form so that we can complete the final refund process. Very small thing mentioned by Himanshu Bhai, but a big speaker Prachi. She's already a lecturer, so hope we'll have a great knowledge sharing from her. Thank you, Prachi. Prachi, over to you now.
Yeah. Thank you. At the outset, I thank the Mulund CACP Study Circle to give me this opportunity to present my views on the recent amendments in the provisions of TDS and TCS. And thank you for the introduction, Himanshu Bhai and Alpesh Bhai. So I welcome all the members who have gathered here today for this session, and it's a new normal of addressing everyone through this online platform, which has its own pros and cons. So without wasting much time, we have a lot of ground to cover, so I would like to share my screen for the presentation today and take it forward. Also, as for most of you who have joined in right now or still in the process of joining in, whatever questions, etc. you have, you may keep typing it, and at the end we'll be having a question answer session, so we'll be taking up queries from the members. So today I have a two-fold agenda over here, which is discussing the recent amendments in TDS and TCS provisions. Now, these provisions are contained in Chapter 17B of the Income Tax Act as such. And the only idea of introducing these provisions in the Income Tax Act was to ensure an early collection of tax. Share my screen. So this is the coverage for my today's session. There are a plethora of changes, and we all know that we are more keen towards the provisions which have changed as far as the TCS provisions are concerned. But there have been certain recent changes in the TDS provisions as well, which I would be taking up. So this is the list of the coverage for today's session that we are going to have in the next couple of hours. So I would be beginning with Section 194M and Section 194N, which were introduced with effect from 1st September 2019. Then we would move on to Section 194O, which was introduced by Finance Act 2020, earlier from 1st April 2020, and then its applicability was deferred to 1st October 2020. Then we would just cover the other amendments in TDS, which would be a quick kind of run through it. And then, of course, we'll be moving on to the changes in the TCS provisions, which are introduction of two subsections under Section 206C of the Income Tax Act. So this is how I would be proceeding. This is the flow of my presentation. Now, let us move on to the first aspect which we're going to cover here is Section 194M. So this was basically brought in by the Finance Act No. 2 of 2019. So 2019 being a budget year, there were two budgets. One was the interim budget, which or a short budget, which came out in February, and then it was in July. And then we also had a Taxation Laws Amendment Act somewhere in December. So this was after the election, the budget that came in, this section was introduced. It was with effect from 1st September 2019. Now, the idea behind introducing this particular section was to take care of those transactions which were otherwise not getting covered by virtue of Section 194C, 194J, or 194H, etc. So, under this particular section, the payer here is an individual or HUF. Other than such individual or HUF who is under an obligation to deduct TDS under 194C, J, H, etc., for carrying out, and what is he paying this amount? This amount is being paid by him for carrying out any kind of work, including supply of labor, for carrying out any work in, under pursuance to any contract, or there is any particular commission which is paid, or brokerage. So typically the brokerage which we pay for acquiring properties, etc., would be covered in this case, or by way of payment of fees for professional services. These are all the payments which are covered here. These kind of payments are covered in the earlier sections of TDS. But here the point is, such individual and HUF, which is taken as the payer under this section, is not under an obligation to deduct TDS under any of the earlier sections. That is the whole idea. So such a person is going to deduct TDS if the aggregate amount of payments which he makes during this year for these reasons are in excess of rupees 50 lakhs, then TDS at the rate of 5% is required to be made on the total sum. Now, before we deliberate upon the operation as such of this section, let us first understand what exactly is intended to cover as far as its scope is concerned. So, like the beginning wordings of the section say, it covers such individual and HUF who is not responsible to deduct TDS under 194CH or J, etc. So we all know in those particular sections of Chapter 17B of the Income Tax Act, such individuals whose turnover in the preceding financial year is exceeding the limit specified for the purpose of 44AB are under an obligation to deduct tax at source whenever they are making any of the payments which are covered by these particular sections. So in this particular section 194M, we are looking at those kind of individuals and HUFs who are not fulfilling this criteria as far as their business turnover or professional receipts are concerned. So those kind of assessees who are whose gross receipts or turnover in the preceding previous year is below the limit of Section 44AB, those would be covered here. Secondly, if we just kind of, you know, do a quick recap of Section 194J, etc., they have a kind of exclusion there that if any fee for professional services is paid by a payer for such contracts which are undertaken by him for personal purposes, then those kind of transactions are outside the purview of Section 194J. So again, they would be coming into this particular section's ambit. So just to illustrate with a few examples, supposing Mr. A appoints a lawyer for some dispute on his personal matters and he pays a professional fee which is in excess of 50 lakhs during the year under consideration. So because this particular payment of professional fee would be outside the scope of Section 194J, because of the way the section is worded, Mr. A would be under an obligation to deduct TDS on this professional fee under the provisions of Section 194M. Just to illustrate further, suppose there is a person who is not earning any income under the head business income. Correct? Let's say he's a salaried employee or he just has investments, etc., and he's earning just the return on those investments. He gives out a contract to renovate his particular bungalow or flat, etc., to a contractor, and the aggregate amount which he is supposed to pay to that contractor on account of this renovation or this upgradation work in the year under consideration is likely to exceed 50 lakhs. So if at all it exceeds the amount of 50 lakhs, then on the total amount which has been paid by this person to the resident contractor, the TDS at the rate of 5% is going to be made. So this is in brief about the coverage of the section. Now talking about the threshold which has been specified. Now, like I said, this section has come into effect from 1st September 2019. So the applicability of this section as far as the levy of TDS is concerned as to when to deduct TDS, it would come into force only from 1st September, so on or after 1st September. But for the purpose of determining the threshold criteria of 50 lakhs, we're going to cover all the payments which have been made during the previous year for determining this 50 lakhs criteria. So this logic comes out from the fact that the section uses the terminology aggregate amount of payments made during the previous year. So we're going to be looking at all the payments which are made in the previous year. So this is just a brief about this particular section. Now what I have done is I have put down a few illustrations as far as this particular section is concerned. And there are about 5 illustrative instances. I'm sure looking at each of these would enable us to kind of get a broader perspective of the section. So I would like to proceed with these illustrations. So the first one is, Mr. Rahul is an individual. He makes payment the following payments to a resident contractor. He makes a payment of INR 27 lakhs on 10th of August 2019 and INR 26 lakhs on 22nd November 2019. Examine in the light of following situations. So this information is going to remain common for all the 5 scenarios which I have evaluated on the slides. So this particular detail that he's going to make payment in 2 tranches. The first one is made in August 2019 of 27 lakhs and the second one is made in November 2019 of 26 lakhs. This data remains common. Mr. Rahul is an individual, that data remains common and the payments are being made to a resident contractor. So in the light of these basic facts, let us evaluate these scenarios. Now the first scenario here is Mr. Rahul is a businessman. His books of accounts are audited every year. Audited every year under Section 44AB and the above payments are for business purposes. Now in this scenario, it is clear that this particular person is covered by the provisions of Section 194C because he is required to get his books of accounts audited every year. So it is understood that his turnover in the preceding financial year has crossed the turnover limits specified under Section 44AB and therefore he is covered by the provisions of Section 194C. And therefore, the provisions of Section 194M are not applicable in this particular case. So this is the first scenario which I had put up over here. Moving on to the second scenario, Mr. Rahul is a businessman. His books are not audited in the immediately preceding financial year as the threshold is lower than the limit of 1 crore because we are talking of 1920. And payment to the contractor is for business purposes. Now, under this particular scenario, even though he is a business assessing, the fact which has been put out here is that his books are not audited in the immediately preceding financial year because his turnover was lower than the limits specified for the purpose of tax audit. And the payment is being made for business purpose. So, because he is outside the scope of Section 194C, in this particular situation, 194M will become applicable. And if you look at the facts which have been put up at the beginning of this case study, the aggregate payments which are being made by Mr. Rahul in the financial year 1920 are INR 53 lakhs. And therefore, when the second tranche, so he's exceeding the limit specified of 50 lakhs. So when he's making payments in the second tranche of this 26 lakhs, which is being paid in the month of November 2019, he would be under an obligation to make TDS at 5% on 26 lakhs. That comes to 1,30,000 and pay it to the credit of the government. So this is the second scenario. It was squarely covered under the provisions of Section 194C, and therefore it is outside the provisions of Section 194M. Moving on to the third situation. In the third scenario, the facts remain the same. 53 lakhs have been paid during the previous year. Mr. Rahul is an individual. Now, the additional information which is given here in the third scenario is the payment is being made to a contractor and it is for personal purposes. So, supposing his house is under renovation or there is some particular personal maintenance contract, etc., which he is appointed that contractor for, and that is the reason why this 53 lakhs is being paid to that particular contractor. Now, here, because these kind of contracts are outside the scope of Section 194C, this transaction will be covered by 194M. And TDS will be applicable whenever Mr. Rahul makes the second tranche of payment in the month of November 2019. And TDS at the rate of 5% on the 26 lakhs component which he is paying will be applicable. I would just like all of your attention to be drawn to the fact that TDS is required to be made on the total sum once it exceeds 50 lakhs, unlike 194N, which we're going to take up in a couple of minutes. So here what has happened is the first tranche is paid before the section having come into effect, and the second tranche of 26 lakhs is paid after the section came into effect, which is also the reason, the payment of this 26 lakhs is also the reason why the threshold of 50 lakhs has been exhausted and it has exceeded. So from this 26 lakhs, the assessing, the payer would under, be an obligation to deduct TDS and pay it to the credit of the government. Now, before I discuss scenario D, I would just take you back to the provisions briefly. Now, here what has happened is about the payer's residential status, nothing has been clarified by the section per se. As far as the payee's residential status is concerned, the section says that the payee has to be a resident. So whomsoever I'm paying this contract fee or the professional fee or the commission or brokerage to, that individual or that concern has to got to be a resident. Nothing has been specified about the payer in the bare section. So here is scenario D before you, wherein Mr. Rahul is a non-resident Indian, not having any business income in India. Despite this, he has paid that 53 lakhs in the financial year 1920 to the contractor for his personal purposes. Now, he's not having any business income in India. He's a non-resident in India. But still, the provisions of Section 194M will be applicable because they do not carve out any specific exception wherein the payer is a non-resident. The provisions merely say that the section is applicable where the payee is a resident. So my payer in this case can be a non-resident if he is fulfilling all the other criteria which has been laid down by Section 194M, so far as to the threshold is concerned, so far as to the kind of expenses covered over here are concerned, in that case, TDS will have to be made and the provisions of Section 194M will be applicable. This is one fine point which arises out of this particular section. Moving on to the last scenario, which we are going to cover for 194M in the slide today. So again, the last scenario brings out an interesting perspective. Now here, the individual who is incurring this kind of expenditure is earning certain exempt income. So he is earning certain agricultural income, which is exempt for the purpose of income tax. Of course, it is included for the rate purpose, but per se, there is no direct tax as far as the agricultural income component is concerned. So in this case, my assessee is earning some exempt income. Are the provisions of Section 194M applicable? Say he makes this 53 lakhs to a resident contractor for some contract which he has undertaken. The issue here is whether 194M would come into effect. So again, when we look at the bare provisions of Section 194M, they don't have any such criteria that the assessee or the payer has to make these kind of payments through his taxable income or through such income which is offered to tax. Only condition is that he should be outside the scope of Section 194C, H, J, etc. And the payments which are being made by him should fall under the specified criteria. in that case, Section 194M becomes applicable. So my answer to the last scenario which I have put up here would be that even in the case that the assessee is earning certain exempt income, the provisions of Section 194M would be applicable and the assessee would be under an obligation to make this 5% TDS once all the other conditions are fulfilled. So, friends, these were the five scenarios which came up from an analysis of Section 194M. This is how the bare section in its various illustrative forms looks like. Now, let us move ahead and look at some of the compliance or practical aspects which have been recently changed as far as this particular section is concerned. So here in this case, the TDS which is deducted under the provisions of Section 194N has to be paid to the credit of the government within 30 days from the end of the month in which such TDS is made. So the payment window which is available to these kind of assessees who are making any deductions under Section 194M is within 30 days from the end of the month in which this TDS is originally deducted. The remittance has to be made electronically accompanied by Chalan Kam statement, which is in Form 26QD. Also, the payer is supposed to give a certificate in Form 16D to the payee within 15 days from the due date of submission of Form 26QD. So once he is electronically remitted the tax and also accompanied it by a Chalan Kam statement, from that period in a span of 15 days, this particular certificate has to be provided to the payee. So this is the compliance aspect. These amendments to these rules came in the month of July this year, and they kind of facilitated the amendments which were brought about earlier by the Finance Act. So this was about the compliance part as far as Section 194M is concerned. I hope whatever has been discussed till now is clear. So if at all there are any queries with regards to TDS, whatever has been discussed, you can keep posting them in the chat box. We'd be taking them all up at the end of the session. Okay. So moving forward, the next section which we are going to deal today under TDS provisions is Section 194N. So the before you know I go on to deliberate upon the provisions of Section 194N, let me just highlight one particular fact. Section 194N was originally brought in by Finance Act No. 2 of 2019 and it is effective from 1st September 2019. So for the financial year 19-20, assessment year 20-21, we have this particular provision which is applicable. Again, the Finance Act 2020, when the bill was passed, there were some changes made to 194N, which are in terms of the threshold criteria or proviso being inserted as far as the non-filers of return of income are concerned. So I have taken up both these situations. So FY 1920 as well as FY 2021 is covered in these slides. So we'll be, of course, discussing them chronologically. Most of the things remain the same. The only deliberation which is additional is the insertion of the proviso by Finance Act 2020, which kind of changes few things, which we'll be looking at towards the end of this discussion of 194N. So before we move on to that, let us understand the provision the way it was introduced by Finance Act 2019 Act No. 2. So this particular section, the payer is a banking company or a post office or a cooperative society which is engaged in the business of banking. The amount which is paid here is any sum or aggregate of sums which are paid in cash, which is typically the withdrawal which is made by the account holder in excess of INR 1 crore during the previous year. The rate of TDS specified under this section is 2%. So the way the section originally came from in FY 1920 with effect from 1st September 19, it is such that if at all there is a person who is an account holder with a particular bank or a post office or a cooperative society and during the year his aggregate withdrawals in cash from this particular bank, okay, all the branches, all the accounts of different branches taken together, his withdrawal from a particular bank is in excess of INR 1 crore, then the bank or the payer of this amount is under an obligation to make TDS at the rate of 2%. So these were the original provisions which were introduced. Now this section 194N was a very surprising and a path-breaking section, because as we all understand the concept of TDS, TDS is something in the nature of withholding tax, which logically and historically has been made only in the case of expenses incurred by the assessee. So as a payer of certain expenditure, I am under an obligation to deduct TDS. That is how the provisions or the mechanism of TDS works. However, section 194N makes a stark departure from this logic of TDS, and it goes on to say that if you are an assessee being a bank account holder and if you are withdrawing certain amounts from the bank, then there's going to be a TDS. So the intention of introducing these provisions was to ensure, or rather to discourage, huge withdrawals in terms of cash withdrawals. So much has been deliberated upon this. I would not take it up more at this juncture. Let us understand the provision in brief. The section carves out certain exceptions. So it says that the provisions of section 194N are not applicable wherein the payments are made to the government, the banking company or cooperative society which is carrying on the business of banking, or a post office, any correspondent business of a banking company or a cooperative society, any white label automated teller machine operator of a banking company, that's the ATM machines which are there for these kind of companies, banking companies, etc. And lastly, any other person or class of persons which the central government may specify. So these were the carve-outs which were given by this section. Now let us look at what were the exclusions which were specified by the central government. So I think one of it would make sense to a few of our clients, so we should be aware of that. So the first exclusion was in the case of cash replenishment agencies, which are the CRAs, and agents of white label automated teller. So these agencies are entrusted with the function of replenishing the cash in the ATM machine. So obviously their amount of withdrawals and deposits and their dealings in cash is going to cross the threshold. So there has been a carve out in respect of these agencies with the condition that a separate bank account has to be maintained from which this withdrawal is made. And the purpose for making this withdrawal is only for the purpose of replenishing the cash in the ATM machine. That's the first condition. The second condition states the certificate for reconciliation of the cash withdrawn from this particular designated account and the cash deposited in this particular ATM machine should be available. So, basis the fulfillment of these two conditions, these kind of agencies are excluded from the application of Section 194N. Moving forward, the second carve out in terms of applicability of Section 194N is in the case of a commission agent or a trader who is operating under any APMC and he is registered under any law relating to agricultural produce market. So if at all we have any agents or any traders who are operating under this APMC and they are duly registered under the respective legislations governing them, in that case, they would also be excluded from the applicability of Section 194N if these conditions are fulfilled. Now, what are the conditions which are fulfilled? First, the bank account number from which such withdrawal, which is in excess of 1 crore, is being made, should be intimated. Secondly, the withdrawal from these accounts should be made only for the purpose of payment to farmers. And thirdly, the PAN should be correctly quoted and the trader should be duly registered. So this is a carve out in terms of commission agents or traders who are operating under the APMC regime. The third kind of carve outs which have recently come in by way of a notification, they are for authorized dealers and its franchisees or agents or sub agents, as have been defined by the Reserve Bank of India. And also full-fledged money changers, that's FFMCs again, which have been licensed by RBI or their franchisee agents, they are again excluded from the applicability of Section 194N. So these were the provisions as they were introduced by Finance Act No. 2 of 2019. Now, few points about this section before we move forward. Now, this section is applicable for withdrawals which are made from each bank account. All the branches of a bank are to be considered together. There is a separate threshold for different bank accounts, and by now I believe all of us are aware of the fact that all the withdrawals which are made from 1st April 2019 have to be considered for the threshold. However, applicability of TDS is going to be only with effect from 1st September 2019. Now let us move on to what changes Finance Act 20 brought about in this particular section. So firstly, this particular amendment which came in Finance Act 20, it was not there at the bill stage, I believe. It came in directly when the bill was passed as an act. It says that TDS at the rate of 2% is required if the withdrawal during the year, is in case of an account holder who has not filed his return of income for 3 years and the withdrawal exceeds 20 lakhs, but it is less than 1 crore. So then the rate of TDS is 2%. Now, in case of an assessee who is withdrawing these sums from the bank and he is a non-filer of his return of income, we are going to deliberate upon that in detail. So, and the withdrawals are in excess of 1 crore, TDS at the rate of 5% has to be made. So, this is the amendment which has come in by way of Finance Act 2020. And let us look at the proviso, which is the one which has been inserted as a virtue of this amendment. So the proviso here says that provided in the case of a recipient who has not filed the return of income for all of the 3 assessment years relevant to the 3 previous years for which the time limit for filing of return of income under subsection 1 of section 139 has expired immediately preceding the previous year in which the payment of sum is made to him, the provision of this section shall apply with the modification. So this is for those assessees who have defaulted in furnishing their return of income for all the 3 preceding previous years, right? Preceding the year in which this withdrawal is made. Now, this what we discussed about is the modification in the applicability of the provision. So if your withdrawal is in excess of 20 lakhs, but it is less than 1 crore, TDS at 2% is required to be made. And in case of these non-filers, if your withdrawal is in excess of 1 crore, TDS at the rate of 5% is required to be made. Now, I have kind of tabulated this situation in our table for 2 years. So for financial year 20, that's for the year 2021. And again, for the year assessment year 2021 and 21-22 is what I have put up on this table. Let us analyze how this section is going to operate in terms of this proviso, which has come into effect. Now, the date of withdrawal here, 1st July, 1st August, 1st September, and 1st December 2020 is my date of withdrawals. Let us say the due dates for filing return of income are 30th November 2020. So in the first 2 cases, there is no audit applicability. In the second, in the last 2 cases, there is an audit applicability. Whether return of income for assessment year 2021 is due, so on 1st July, it is not due. Therefore, the 3 preceding previous years for which I have to check for the person who's withdrawing these amounts from the bank is assessment year 1920, 1819 and 1718. So this is when my due date of return is 30th November. My date of withdrawal is 1st July 2020 because these provisions have come into effect. I mean, this was with effect from 1st July 2020. So the 3 preceding previous years which I'm going to look at is 1920, 1819 and 1718. Going to the second case, my due date is 30th November. My date of withdrawal is 1st August 2020. There's no audit applicability. My ROI date is not yet due. So again, the 3 years which I'm going to look at is 1920, 1819 and 1718. Going on to the third scenario, my date of withdrawal is 1st September. Audit applicability is there. My ROI is not yet due. So again, the 3 years which I'm going to look at is the same, 1920, 1819 and 1718. Now, what happens is, if the due date of filing return has passed or has elapsed, correct? And my withdrawal date is 1st December 2020. There's no audit applicability. My return of income is due, correct? Then the filing status has to be checked for AY 2021, AY 1920, and 1890. This would be the situation for this particular assessment year. If we just assume that next year the due dates don't get modified or extended or whatever, and we look at this scenario for the next year, that is 21-22. So if my date of withdrawal is 1st July, in that case, the three preceding years for which my return has to be verified is 20-21, 19-20, and 18-19. Likewise, if it is August, my due date for filing my return of income has passed. So I would be looking at the current year as well and the preceding two previous years. So this is just a table which I have put up here. The real issues which would be coming up as a result of this are put up on this slide. Now, firstly, the insertion of this proviso states that there is the onus on the tax deductor to evaluate each of the recipients and confirm their filing status, because the modification in the provisions of TDS rates is going to be applicable only if you have not filed your return of income for the past 3 years. So the tax deductor is now going to verify each of the recipients and confirm his return filing status for the last 3 years on an ongoing basis. Now, what I mean by ongoing basis, it is going to be directly linked with your date of withdrawal being pre or post your date of filing return. So long as it is pre date of filing return, the earlier 3 years have to be taken into consideration. Once the withdrawal is post your current year's return filing date, the current year also has to be taken into question. So just imagine the banks or the cooperative societies who are already so hard pressed for staff and time and efficiency, if they would be now required to keep a track of this information, I see some kind of difficulties in the manner in which the implementation of this section after the amendment by Finance Act 2020 is going to take place. So secondly, the way out would be, the deductors will now ask a declaration from the deductee about his filing status, and at certain periodicity, this particular declaration has to be amended, after every return filing date which lapses. That is the only way they are going to be able to ensure compliance with this particular section. And that would also mean additional documentation as far as the deductor of tax is concerned, because now they would have to keep all information relating to the return filing status of deductees. So, of course, they would be a very small number of bank account holders who would be withdrawing these kind of sums in one financial year. But it does mean some increased bank workload as far as the banks are concerned. Also, one question or one issue which comes up here is, how would the proviso operate in the case of newly formed entities with no previous track record of return filing? So like we saw, the proviso states that the modification in the TDS rates and threshold would be applicable when the assessee or the person who's withdrawing this money has defaulted in submitting his return of income for the past 3 years. So for a newly formed entity, it would be difficult to ascertain this condition, and there is right now no clarity as to how would they keep a track, or merely they would deduct TDS at the modified rates because no previous record is available. So there needs to be some kind of clarity as far as this aspect is concerned. So this was about section 194N. We covered these two tabulated versions. We covered the modification which has come in on account of the proviso, which is inserted by Finance Act 20. And all the other points about the thresholds being applicable for the whole year, they would have been settled by now, because as such, it's quite some time that the section has found its way in the Income Tax Act provisions. So the next point which we would be taking up for discussion is section 194O. Again, a very interesting section, I would say. Okay, yeah. Just give me a minute. we all know there has been a great amount of increase in terms of the digital transactions or the e-commerce operations that are happening all around us. And this pandemic has sort of accelerated these kind of transactions to a completely higher level. So I would say that because of the fact that we are all operating remotely, these kind of e-commerce transactions have grown way too fast than what they would have otherwise grown in a normal scenario. Nonetheless, that is the situation which has happened now, but the government sort of envisaged a growth in the digital manner of conducting transaction and has brought in section 194O under the income tax provisions with effect from 1st October 2020. This was inserted by Finance Act 2020. Earlier, it was supposed to take effect from 1st April 2020, and then its applicability was deferred to 1st October. And so now we have this particular section, which is here to stay with us. Now, because it's a new concept and it is an extremely interesting one at the outset, I would say, let us have a small understanding of the provisions in proper, you know, before we can move on to discussing the issues or the probable difficulties which could arise as far as the TDS regimen in this case is concerned. So under section 194O, there is a sale of goods or there are certain services which are being provided of an e-commerce participant, and this kind of sale or provision of service is facilitated by an e-commerce operator. Now, the e-commerce operator is facilitating this sale or these services through its digital or electronic network or platform. Correct? Now, if this is true, then the e-commerce operator is going to make TDS at the rate of 1% of the gross amount of sale, service, or both, which he's going to pay to the e-commerce participant. Also, at times, there might be certain payments which are made directly by the consumers or the recipients of these goods or services to the e-commerce participant. In respect of such payments as well, it will be deemed that this amount is being paid by the e-commerce operator to the e-commerce participant. Now, this is what the bare provision has to say, and then there are meanings of the term e-commerce operator, e-commerce participant, etc. But you know, before I move on to that, just a point which came to my mind. In the various sections which I have deliberated till now for TDS, as well as what I'm going to do further, I have mentioned the rates which are the original rates given out by the section. Now, as we all know, there was a notification under the various relief measures announced by the government on the 14th of May, which was later authorized by the Taxation Amendment Ordinance Bill, which later on became the Act. And the TDS and the TCS rates have been slashed by 25% of what they were so far as financial year 2021 is concerned. Therefore, even though I am saying the rate of 1% here, because I'm discussing the bare provision, for the financial year 2021, the applicable rate is going to be 0.75%. Likewise, for that 5% and the 2%, everything is going to be reduced by 25% so far as this financial year in question is concerned. All right. So I just said it once, blanket, applicable to all these slides. Now, let's go on to understand this section again. So, there is an e-commerce operator, there is an e-commerce participant, there is certain sale or there is a provision of services which takes place because the e-commerce operator facilitates it for an e-commerce participant. So, whatever amount he's paying, the gross amount, the e-commerce operator is under an obligation to make TDS at the rate of 1%. Now, there's no requirement to deduct this TDS if the e-commerce participant is an individual or an HOF and the gross amount of sale or services or both which are provided by this e-commerce participant is not in excess of 5 lakhs, right? and the PAN and Aadhaar has been furnished to the e-commerce operator. So during the year, if the aggregate amount of sale or service or both, which is provided by an e-commerce participant, being an individual or HUF, is not exceeding INR 5 lakhs, and he's also submitted his PAN and Aadhaar, PAN or Aadhaar details to the e-commerce operator, there would not be any requirement to make TDS. So the intention seems that small businessmen, right, who are listing themselves on these kind of e-commerce operators and conducting their businesses through them, are sought to be excluded from these TDS provisions. And the definition of small businessmen, which this section has sort of fixed at, is such kind of businessmen being individuals or HUFs who are listing their products or services, and the aggregate amount which they are collecting by way of sales of these is not in excess of 5 lakhs. So if it crosses 5 lakhs, I no longer am covered by the benefit, and the e-commerce operator is under an obligation to make TDS in respect of the amount which he pays. Also, if a particular transaction, so this was the first exclusion or the first scenario we discussed wherein TDS is not required to be made. The second aspect here is where a transaction is covered under this section, no TDS has to be made under any other sections. So, you know, there might be some overlapping as far as provision of services is concerned or a contract is concerned. Part of it might be covered under 194J, etc. But then once we say that 194O has come into operation, the other sections you might just kind of ignore for the time being, and there would be no TDS under any of the other sections of Chapter 17B. So these are some additional points about 194O which we can keep in mind. Now, the third point here is, and I would like all of you to pay attention to this, you know, it is quite difficult to just stare at the screen and keep on talking. I hope everyone is with me and on the same page as the discussion is going on. So this particular point I would like to highlight over here is that these provisions are not applicable to the amounts which are received or receivable. So see, all this while we are talking about the e-commerce operator making certain payments to the e-commerce recipient and making certain TDS in respect of those payments which he makes. Moving further, this particular section says that these provisions are not applicable to amounts received or receivable by the e-commerce operator for these two purposes. The first one is hosting any kind of advertisements. And the second is providing any services which are not in connection with the sale and services of the products basically which are being listed. So we'd be coming back and revisiting what this could probably mean in the light of Section 194O. For now, I would like all of you to just keep in your mind that there is these two exclusions to which the provisions of Section 194O are not to be made applicable, and they are concerned with receipts made by the e-commerce operator. Right? Now, let us look at the meaning of the terms which have been covered by this section. The first is electronic commerce. It means the supply of goods or services or both, including digital products over digital or electronic network. So basically, it's an online marketplace, right, wherein certain goods or services or both are listed, they're advertised, and their sale takes place over an electronic network. So this is the first term as far as electronic commerce is concerned. The second is e-commerce operator. So an e-commerce operator is a person who owns, operates, or manages digital or electronic facility or platform for e-commerce. Right? So we have all the Amazons and the Flipkarts and Airbnbs, etc., who are the e-commerce operators who are providing specific product-wise or segment-wise platforms for such dealers and sellers and resellers who can list themselves on these platforms and conduct sale of their goods and services. The third term which is defined here is e-commerce participant. And in this case, it means a person who is resident in India. So I would like to draw your attention to the fact, as far as e-commerce operator was concerned, Nothing is being specified about the residential status of that person who is acting in the capacity of an e-commerce operator. But as far as an e-commerce participant is concerned, it says, and it quite exhaustively defines it to mean a person who is resident in India, selling goods or providing services or both, including digital products through digital or electronic facility or platform for e-commerce. Right? And then services again is same, that is the fees for technical services and professional services as is covered in the explanation to section 194G. Now, because, you know, typically CAs like us would not be routinely dealing with these things, and yet it is quite interesting, I just thought it would be good enough to understand what these terms digital platforms or electronic platforms mean. So see, basically there is some element of difference when we talk from the technology front as far as a digital and an electronic kind of scenario is concerned. But when we talk of an e-commerce operation or a marketplace, digital platform and electronic platform can, I would say, you know, taking the liberty of saying this, they are capable of being used interchangeably. So digital platforms are basically online businesses which will facilitate commercial interactions between two different groups, one being the supplier and the other being the consumers. And electronic platform is something which is more wholesome or something which is more, I would say, elaborate. It will provide a website, it will provide a platform network, it will provide some manner in which a payment can be made, a service can be delivered, downloaded, or a product can be delivered. So that is something which is an electronic platform. Now, there are several types of digital platforms. For example, you have social media platforms, you have knowledge sharing platforms, you have professional platforms, plus you have these online marketplaces. So some examples of these kind of platforms would be Amazon, Airbnb, Zomato, Swiggy, etc. So all these would classify as e-commerce operators. Now, because this section is new, I just thought of taking up two or three illustrations. So they always help in clarifying what the section is trying to mean. So they are graphic more or less, and we all are doing it in our day-to-day lives. The only thing is to kind of understand it from the taxation perspective and then go on to understand the more complex issue involved in these kind of transactions. So the first scenario I have covered here is, let us say there is an end consumer, Mr. A. There is an e-commerce operator, which is Zomato, and there is Subway, which is a well-known restaurant chain, which is an e-commerce participant, which has listed itself on this e-commerce operator. Now, Mr. A looks up on the Zomato app. He finds Subway registered on it. He orders something from Subway, and he makes an online payment of 500 rupees for his order, right? Like Mr. A, there'll be hundreds and thousands of consumers who would be ordering through Zomato from various e-commerce participants who are listed on the e-commerce operator. So what is going to happen is, this 500 rupees, which is being paid in my example by Mr. A to Subway directly, will be deemed to have been paid by Zomato to Subway, and it'll be included in the gross sales for the purpose of making TDS. This would be the first implication. So on this particular 500, for this particular year, 0.75%, Zomato will make TDS and will pay it to the credit of the government. As far as the e-commerce participant is concerned, Subway will claim the credit of this TDS while filing its return of income. To my mind, this is how it is going to operate on a very, very elementary form of this transaction, which I have put forth. Great. Now let us look at a different scenario wherein my consumer here is Mr. B. Again, this e-commerce operator which is concerned here is Zomato, and the e-commerce participant who is listed on Zomato this time is an individual by the name Ramlal Spauvaji. All right. So he is kind of a street vendor or a small time local restaurant in a small suburb, but he has listed himself on Zomato. Now, Mr. B, being a consumer, he orders some food from Ramlal's Pav Bhaji, and he makes a cash on delivery payment to the guy who comes to deliver this parcel to him, right? Now, in this case, what changes is the fact that my e-commerce participant is an individual. And on further analysis, let us assume his gross sales are less than the prescribed threshold of INR 5 lakhs. Now, in this case, whatever is the amount which is being earned by this Ramlal's Pav Bhaji on account of his listing on the e-commerce operator being Zomato, there would be no requirement for TDS because we are not fulfilling the criteria as far as the threshold limit is concerned. And I'm also assuming that Ramlal has submitted his PAN or Aadhaar number to the e-commerce operator at the time of being listed on that service. Now, assume if Ramlal's Pav Bhaji's annual sales are more than 5 lakhs, TDS at the rate of 1% will have to be made, correct? And in this scenario, if he's not submitted his PAN or Aadhaar, then this TDS rate would be spiked up to 5%. So this is how this section would operate so far as an individual e-commerce participant is concerned in both the scenarios, his sales being more than 5 lakhs or his sales being less than 5 lakhs. Now, there's one point, you know, which had come to my mind when this section came in by way of the bill when it came in. This 5 lakhs, which is to be seen, right? I have no conclusive answer on this. What is my logical understanding of the provision? I'm putting it forth. There could be different views and I'm open to that, right? So when I'm talking of this gross annual sales of 5 lakhs, am I supposed to see it vis-a-vis e-commerce operator Zomato or vis-a-vis all the various e-commerce operators on which this Ramlal's Pav Bhaji is listed and also include such sales which do not take place through e-commerce operators? So, I mean, just, you know, let me elaborate what is there in my mind. Suppose Ramlal's Pav Bhaji is listed on Zomato, he is listed on Swiggy, plus he also has his stall wherein people come, dine and go away. So, when I'm looking at this annual sales of this particular e-commerce participant, is it qua e-commerce operator, operator-wise, or is it for all such sales taken together by way of being listed on various e-commerce operators, including those sales which take place by ways other than e-commerce business, you know? So there will be people who would be just walking by his restaurant, eating and coming back. Now, to my mind, if you look at the intention of the particular exclusion of this person being excluded is to kind of exclude small businessmen. So from that idea, I would like to make a holistic approach towards this and say that all kind of sales which take place at Ramlal's Pav Bhaji restaurant would have to be considered for the purpose of determining whether it is in excess of 5 lakhs or not. So now there is again an operational issue which comes up. How would Zomato be aware what his gross sales for the year are, both through e-commerce and outside of e-commerce? So again, I believe there would be some procedural requirements which would have to come into effect for the purpose of implementation of this section, wherein the e-commerce operator would have to maybe obtain an undertaking from the e-commerce participant stating that his annual gross, I mean his gross annual sales from sale of this particular product or service for the year is going to be less than 5 lakhs. So, you know, that is the immediate thing which came to my mind so far as the applicability and the implementation was concerned. But there could be different views. We all will have to wait and watch how this section actually manifests itself as far as the applicability part is concerned. So this was a scenario number two. Now we'll move on further to another illustration which I'm taking up. So I can see a few questions. So we'll take them up at the end of the session. That would be logically better rather than breaking my flow and everybody else's flow because one participant's question would throw everything off gear. So I'll be answering all the questions to the best of my ability. Let's look at the third scenario in this case. Now here, there is a consumer, Ms. C. Amazon is my e-commerce operator here. And Shilpi's Boutique is a particular fashion designer or a shop which is listed on Amazon e-commerce. Now, this Ms. C purchases something through this boutique and she makes an online payment directly to Shilpi's Boutique. Now, 3,000 will be deemed to have been paid by Amazon to Shilpi's boutique and will be included in the gross sales for the purpose of TDS. And Amazon is going to make TDS at the rate of 1%, that is for this year, 0.75%, and deposit it with the government. And Shilpi's boutique can claim credit of this TDS in its return of income. So this is effectively the same way as the earlier case. Only the thing is, here I covered a different line of business, and there what we covered was restaurants. Now, before we move on to the next thing which I have in mind, I would just take you back to this slide, and I would bring you back to these two points over here. So the section says that these provisions are not applicable to amounts which are received or receivable by the e-commerce operator for hosting any advertisements or for providing any services not in connection with the sale or services of the typical goods or products which are being sold. So to be honest and to be fair, this aspect is a little bit confusing with small amounts of clarity. But if I just keep law aside for a minute and bring in logic, I would rather understand it to be that there are various, of course, the e-commerce participants who are listing themselves on the e-commerce operator's website or other platforms, they would have to pay a certain fee if they want their particular product or service to come up. As far as the search results are concerned, they would have to pay some extra money in terms of advertisement, to my mind. So I believe that amounts which are paid by or which are received by these e-commerce operators will have no effect insofar as the determination of gross amounts paid by the e-commerce operator to the participant goes. So kisi bhi tarah ka adjustment yahan I think nahi karna hai. So suppose the e-commerce operator is to receive 10 rupees from the e-commerce participant, and the e-commerce operator has to pay 1,000 rupees in terms of the sales or the deemed sales. So TDS will have to be made on the 1,000 rupees. There is no need to adjust this 10 rupees or 100 rupees, which is received on account of these two things. That is what comes to my mind, right? But I don't have any more bandwidth than what I just discussed, but this is the logical thing which comes to my mind. So this is about what I had to tell you about those two exclusions. Now let us move on to the fourth scenario over here. And here I would just like to first discuss this and then twist this scenario a bit. So there's a consumer, Mr. D. There is a e-commerce operator which goes by the name Airbnb. And there is an e-commerce participant, which is Nature's Trails Homestay, which is listed there. So the consumer is looking out for some homestay in a particular location, and he comes across this particular homestay facility offered, which is listed on Airbnb. He makes an online payment of 20,000 and books himself there. Now this 20,000 will be deemed that Airbnb is paying it to this Nature Trails, and it will be liable to TDS at the rate of 1%. So ANB will be making this TDS, crediting it to the government. Nature Trails Homestay, if eligible, will claim the credit of this TDS in filing its return of income. So this was a very simple, again, extension of the earlier scenarios, but I would like to change the facts here before we go on to a complex issue as far as 194O is concerned. Now, let us assume that Airbnb is a non-resident e-commerce operator, right? I mean, just assume that Airbnb is a non-resident e-commerce operator, because in the course of making this case study and evaluating upon this, I did find out that Airbnb has a subsidiary Indian company, which is a subsidiary of its foreign company. So it might have a residential status, but for the purpose of my case study, it is a non-resident. Okay, as far as the bare section is concerned, there is no requirement that the e-commerce operator has to be a resident or a non-resident. The e-commerce participant has at all times to be a resident. That is the only condition. So now here, first of all, because this Airbnb is a non-resident, you would still have to make this TDS at 1% and pay to the credit of the government. For all you know, this Airbnb might just have a digital presence in India. It might not even have any PE or any physical office, etc. in India. But because it is targeting a certain, it's targeting a certain amount of customers in India, and it's also enabling other non-residents to book these kind of stays in India, it would have to undergo this whole regime of deducting TDS and paying it to the credit of the government, for which purpose, you know, all the other formalities associated with TDS, like getting the TAN and filing the quarterly statements, etc., I believe would come into picture. So this is the scenario wherein the e-commerce operator is a non-resident. So far, it sounds simple, except the administrative hassles which this particular entity would have to undergo. But I would now like to draw your attention to one small amendment which Finance Act 2020 made, which is likely to have far-reaching effects. So now they have extended the equalization levy to non-resident e-commerce operators as well, who are providing goods or services to residents in India and non-residents as well, if it pertains to online advertising which is targeted in India. So like I said, just let's assume that Airbnb doesn't have any subsidiary entity in India. It's a totally foreign company. It may or may not have a PE in India. It does have a digital presence in India wherein it is advertising its products on Indian websites, you know, those what's that called? IP addresses which are located in India, and it is targeting certain kind of residents in India, and it is enabling them to book these kind of stays by way of these participants which get listed on it. Now, the whole beauty of these kind of digital transactions are that they are location independent. So the geographical boundaries which have been set are totally irrelevant when it comes to these kind of business operations. With that intention in mind, and in accordance with the OECD and the WEPS related action plans, etc., Finance Act 20 said that we are going to extend this equalization levy even to non-resident e-commerce operators. And we already had 194O coming into picture. So now probably what is going to happen is there's likely to be a TDS implication on the part of the e-commerce operator being a non-resident, wherein he has the function to deduct the tax from the e-commerce participants' funds paid to the credit of government. That is his obligation as far as the applicability of 194O is concerned. Plus, he's also going to have additional liability to pay this 2% equalization levy, which is going to be paid quarterly by these kind of non-resident e-commerce operators. So I would still say there are a lot of representations which have been made as far as this is concerned, and there is nothing which is, we can't see it happening right now because it's very new. Possibly what kind of e-commerce operators would be covered here? They could be travel aggregators, they would be cloud support services, search engines, hospitality, maybe online gaming, etc. So these are all the services which are likely to be covered here. And now they will have a twofold effect. As a non-resident e-commerce operator facilitating this sale, the entity is under an obligation to deduct TDS. And because it is now governed by equalization levy, it is going to pay this 2% quarterly. So this is what I just had to pinpoint with regards to these kind of digital transactions which take place. Also, I would just like to add here that because equalization levy is a separate levy in itself, it is not governed by the income tax provisions. It is outside the treaty protection which might be available to certain kind of non-residents, and the DTAAs which we have with various countries would, to my mind, not have any implication as far as this equalization levy was concerned. So this complicates things for non-resident e-commerce operators. So this was, you know, the most of the things which I had to discuss as far as TDS amendments was concerned. Two things with regards to 194O, the exclusions I already discussed. Also, you know, there are these special discounts, promo codes, offers, Amazon Great Indian Festival Sale, etc., which come in wherein they go on to give some cross benefits. So we don't know whether the commerce operator is extending the benefit or the e-commerce participant is extending this benefit, and how these various amounts would be adjusted as far as the sales consideration is concerned. That we would be able to understand in a better way only if we have some live, you know, case on hand. But these are points which we should note or take a note of as far as 194O is concerned. Moving on ahead, now I'll quickly cover all the other sundry amendments which have taken place in TDS, small things here and there, and then we'll move on to the most awaited section for the evening, which is TCS in respect of sale of goods. So first is section 194. As we all know, DDT, that's the dividend distribution tax, was again abolished. So therefore, a corollary would be the reintroduction of TDS provisions as far as dividend is concerned. So there's a TDS rate at 10% of the dividend which is paid to a resident in excess of 5,000 rupees. Again, if the dividend is paid in cash, the threshold remains to be at 2,500. The TDS has to be deducted at the rate of 20% of the dividend if it is paid to a non-resident. So I'm not going much into detail. We all know this because it's nothing new which has come in. It's just a reintroduction of something which had become irrelevant. Moving further, there is a small amendment for section 194A as well. So this is so these amendments which I'm talking of are of Finance Act 20. All right. So we are out of that 1st September 2019 effect, and now we're looking at Finance Act 20 related amendments. So 194A, again, TDS will be applicable in the case of cooperative societies which are making payments or allowing credit of interest other than interest on securities if the sales or gross receipts of these kind of societies exceed INR 50 crores in the preceding financial year. For senior citizens, the threshold stands at 50,000, and for other cases, it is at 40,000. Then we have an interesting amendment as far as section 194C is concerned. So earlier, the TDS provisions for contracts were applicable wherein material was purchased from the customer, right? So now this goes on to say that TDS provisions would be applicable wherein material is purchased from the customer's associate, that is the related party as well. So here again, TDS at the rate of 2% on the work done will be applicable for payments made to residents for manufacturing or supplying a product according to the customer's specification, even when the material is purchased from a party which is related to the customer. And for the definition of related party, we go back to 48(2)(b), which is the specified persons list, right? Next small amendment having far-reaching effects, I would say, is to section 194J. So it has an interesting history. You know, there were certain kind of transactions which had overlapping in terms of whether section 194C should come into picture or section 194J should come into picture. Because those were some typical transactions wherein some people used to argue it's a part and parcel of C or J. So rather than clarifying about what would be technical services, they just said that with effect from 1st April 2020, TDS on fees for technical services other than professional services paid to residents would be reduced from 10% to 2%. So what used to happen was, out of abundant caution, payers used to deduct tax at 10% because there was this lack of clarity as to what exactly which provision would come into application. So rather than clarifying the meaning, to my mind, they further complicated it, saying that technical services hai, so the rate of TDS will be 2%. Professional services hai, other than the technical ones, then it's going to be 10%. So there's a thin line of difference when we purely talk of the definition of technical services and professional services. At this juncture, I would not like to get into the nitty-gritties of it, but far from clarifying confusions, this has further added to it, is my view. All right. Also, TDS on royalty for sale, distribution or exhibition of cinematographic films will also now be made at the rate of 2%. These are the changes as far as 194C and J is concerned. Moving on to one small, procedural related amendment is in section 197A, 1F. So earlier, the central government was empowered to notify certain class of persons who would go and say that, okay, we are applying for a no deduction of tax at source kind of certificate. Now these provisions have been amended to also include notifying certain class of persons who can apply for lower deduction of tax. So that's a procedural amendment which has come in. OK. Okay. So, so far the discussion that we have covered is, we have covered all the amendments with regards to the TDS provisions and both of the Finance Act 2019 and the Finance Act 2020 and their applicability, etc. Taking the discussion further, now I would be discussing the provisions related to TCS. So I would just have a look at the chat box once. Okay, there are 2-3 questions which have come up, which we'll be taking up at the end. All right. So somebody is making a note of these questions in case they kind of, yes. So now we come to discussion of those sections which have, you know, the limelight, which have been the limelight for quite some time now. So just let me give you a brief background. You know, a lot of technical things have been discussed. Let us just kind of break the monotony of me talking all the while and sharing some other things. So when I was a student, all right, we always used to have this kind of discussion, ke yaar TCS kaun padhta hai, chhod do usko. वैसे भी सब सेल ऑफ स्क्रैप एंड लिकर एंड वॉट एवर टेंडू लीव्स एंड ऑल दोज थिंग्स वर यू नो द आइटम्स व्हिच वर कवर्ड विद इन द परव्यू ऑफ दोज सेक्शंस. ऑल्सो व्हेन आई स्टार्टेड टीचिंग अगेन वी यूज्ड टू वेरी कन्वीनियंटली टेल स्टूडेंट्स दैट इट्स ओके यू डू टीडीएस प्रॉपरली टीसीएस इज समथिंग यू नो यू कैन जस्ट हैव अ ग्लांस एंड लेट इट गो एंड You won't believe these provisions, of course, I say you won't believe because it was a revelation to me when I kind of applied my mind to this. These provisions have been in the statute since 1988, all right? So Finance Act 1988 was the first act which introduced TCS provisions in the Income Tax Act. And the whole logic of introducing them was in respect of certain goods like timber or alcoholic liquor, etc. So there was that time a particular section, I think 44AA or something that, way back, which was like a section which enabled collecting tax in respect of such goods sold, which were sold by these contractors in that year itself, because later on these people were simply non-traceable. So as a corollary to that particular section, this TCS provision was introduced wherein it was told that the seller will only collect from the buyer a certain nominal amount of tax and pay it to the credit of the government. So this was the whole idea with which TCS provisions came into the statute. And this was way back in 1988, where I believe most of the returns were filed physically. All the returns were filed physically. And there was nothing like the high-tech systems, which we are so used to now, as far as the Income Tax Act or the GST is concerned. After that, this particular section went on to be amended by inserting again few things wherein they said TCS in respect of sale of motor cars or TCS in respect of jewelry, which they brought in and they again took away, etc. And cut to Finance Act 2020, this section was then amended to say that, okay, now under these provisions, we are going to cover TCS on sale of foreign tours, TCS in respect of remittances which are made outside India, and TCS in respect of sale of goods. The idea which was given was to say that simply we want to widen the base of tax, we want to ensure that there is no evasion of tax, right? Now this is the premise on which these provisions came into statute, and trust me, until 2061 was introduced, most of us would have continued to ignore these provisions because they made little difference to us. Today also, it might not make difference to a lot of us because the threshold criteria which has been specified is somewhat high, I would say. But still, it's something worth applying our minds to. So this is the history of TCS as far as the Income Tax Act is concerned. And my flow when I'm dealing with these provisions here is going to be, first, I'm going to quickly run through the changes as far as the remittances and foreign tours is concerned. And then we would be taking up the most awaited subsection, which is 1H. So I would probably try and make a comment that I'm just assuming and hoping that I'm lucid enough in my delivery. My pace is all right, and people who are listening are not really bored with the constant monotony of discussion. You know, it's so very different on an online platform than it is when we are face to face. All right, so let us move further and discuss. I quickly run through provisions of Section 206(1)(g). All right, so as far as Section 1(g) is concerned, what is covered here is a twofold criteria. So firstly, there is an authorized dealer who's making, there's a person who's approaching an authorized dealer for making certain remittances outside India, which are permitted under the liberalized remittance scheme of the RBI. And second aspect which is covered here is a person who is approaching a tour operator and paying certain amount for purchase of a foreign overseas tour program package. So these are the two aspects which are covered under this subsection. Okay. Now, whenever this amount for remittance is received by the authorized dealer, or when this tour operator receives any consideration for sale of such overseas tour program package, he is under an obligation to make TDS at the rate of 5% with some conditions which we are going to see in the coming slides. So this is the premise of this section. Now before we discuss this, a liberalized remittance scheme is something which the RBI has come out with, which is there for quite a lot of time, and it is applicable only to individual assessees. So other than individuals, talking of HUFs or business entities or partnership firms, corporates, those are not governed by the liberalized remittance scheme. Secondly, there is a typical definition which the subsection has given so far as overseas tour program package is concerned. And the definition makes sense when we look at the entire set of provisions. So going further to the next slide, these are the four provisos to this particular subsection. Don't worry, I'm not going to read all that of content on the slide. I don't like so much content on my slides, but because I can't see all of you, I've just put it here. We're going to straight away discuss the implications of all the four provisos. So the first proviso says, wherein the person who's receiving this money for the purpose of remittance is an authorized dealer, and such amount is received for a purpose which is other than purchase of an overseas tour program package. So it could be someone has raised hand. Alpesh bhai, what is to be done? Uday Rao, I believe, has raised his hand.
Yes, we'll check it out with her, with him.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. So let us say that this particular authorized dealer is receiving some amounts and which are to be remitted. It is for a purpose other than overseas tour program package. So it could be for the purpose of some medical expenses, educational loan, or it could merely be for the purpose of some gift, etc., for which this remittance is to be made. Then this authorized dealer is required to check a threshold of 7 lakhs in a financial year, and he is required to make TCS at 5%. Only if the amount which is to be remitted for one particular individual during the year is in excess of this 7 lakhs threshold. Otherwise, there is no TCS required to be made by the authorized dealer. Supposing the purpose of this remittance is purchase of an overseas tour program package. So at this juncture, I think it makes sense to just tell you what an overseas tour program package is. It is not just buying a particular foreign tour program from the tour operator directly, but it also involves incurring certain expenditure directly. Okay, so maybe the case that the individual himself is booking certain hotel or some kind of arrangements abroad as a part of his foreign stay, or he is wanting to get some foreign exchange to facilitate his expenses when he is on the foreign tour. Either of this could hold true. Now, if the purpose for which the remittance is being made is on account of this overseas tour program package, then the authorized dealer is not required to check the threshold criteria of 7 lakhs, and for any amount which he receives towards this remittance, he is under an obligation to collect 5% towards TCS. That is the first proviso explained. Correct? let's move on to the second proviso. So second proviso again reiterates the same thing. It's a combination what I just discussed. So authorized dealers would be required to make TCS only if the amount which they receive for remittance is crossing 7 lakhs for purposes other than overseas tour program packages. Moving on to the third proviso, which talks of remittances which are made on account of education. So here again, you know, when this particular provision came in, a lot of representations were made stating that some kind of concession ought to be given when the remittance is for educational purpose or medical purpose. So as of now, they completely ignored the medical purpose. When the bill became the act, they brought out a relaxation in terms of rate of TCS as far as remittance for educational purpose was concerned. So what they have to say here by way of third proviso is, if the remittance is outside India, it is for the purpose of education, and the remittance is out of a loan which is obtained from a financial institution, then the rate of TCS is going to be 0.5%. Matlab, we are remitting money outside India, we are taking a loan for that, and we have to still budget a 0.5% extra on the loan, because that is also going to be our outflow because we are remitting funds outside. That's the only relaxation they thought they could offer. If this remittance for educational purpose is made out of funds which are through our own savings or through some private loans or some gift, etc., which is given by family members, then even though the purpose remains education, the rate of TCS will still be 5%, because they say that for the purpose of the lower rate coming into picture, the rate, the remittance should be by way of a loan. I mean, the remittance should be out of a loan which is obtained. So this is the third proviso which relates to remittances for education. Moving further, there is right now no special carve out as far as remittances for medical purposes are concerned. So any kind of amounts which are remitting for the treatment or the rehabilitation or the stay of a patient abroad, it is still going to cause an additional outflow of 5% of the amount to be remitted under the LRS scheme. The fourth proviso is a logical one. It says that wherein you make any booking for a foreign tour through a tour operator, the tour operator is already going to collect TCS on your behalf. And then the tour operator is going to approach the authorized dealer to sort of make certain remittances, again, exhausting that individual's LRS quota who made the tour booking. So, wo amount pe dubara, the authorized dealer is not going to make TCS. So, for example, I go to Hina Tours, I book a Europe tour package for 10 days, I pay 5 lakhs as the cost, assume. So, I pay 5 lakhs plus 5% extra, which is TCS collected by Hina Tours. Now, Hina Tours approaches XYZ authorized dealer and says, for Prachi Parekh, we need to make land arrangements and hotel bookings abroad at various locations. So I need to make a remittance of 3 lakhs, exhausting her LRS quota. Now, had this proviso not been there, the authorized dealer would again kind of make a TCS because there was no specific exclusion. So that is a logical proviso which came into the act. Right. So this is about the section in brief. We're not going to discuss much on this because I know most of us are anxious to go on to 1H. Right? These are a few exclusions from the meaning of the term buyer as far as the tour overseas tour program package is concerned, and also for 1H. Okay. So I would just like to draw your attention that buyer, even for the purpose of 1H, excludes, right, central government, state government, embassy, high commission official, etc., etc., local authority as defined in section 1020, and a person who is importing goods into India. So these are the three exclusions. Moving further, meaning of authorized dealer is again same as is defined in section 10 of FEMA and RBI, etc. And overseas tour program package is what I would like to draw your attention to. So it means any tour package which offers visit to a country or countries or territory or territories outside India and includes expenses for travel or hotel stay or boarding or lodging or any other expenditure of similar nature. So anything which is in connection to this tour program package, 7 lakh ka threshold criteria applicable nahi hai. That's the only thing we need to retain from this. All right. Okay. Now, a few quick issues, right, before we close this. Suppose hotel booking or any other remittances are made by individuals directly to overseas entities, what would be the scenario? Again, like I said, it would be covered by the remittances made for the purpose of overseas tour program package and would be liable for TCS without threshold of 7 lakhs. Remittances for educational purposes, we did discuss. Remittances for medical purposes, we did discuss. Now, I would like to draw your attention to the last point first. All right, the last point here, which is currency sale or card sale to business travel. Now, business travel is one of the permitted purposes of LRS. It is included within the LRS, correct? Now, when I'm visiting a foreign country on account of some business travel, I would like to carry some foreign currency with me. I think the limit up to which it is allowed is, I believe, some $3,000 over the counter, you can obtain it. Or I would like to carry a pre-filled foreign currency card for various expenses which I might incur when abroad. So here, if the individual who is going to travel approaches the authorized dealer, there will be a TCS. But one highlighting point here is if the business entity which is sending this person abroad is approaching the authorized dealer to get the foreign currency or to get his card filled, etc., in that particular scenario, there will not be TCS, because TCS is very, very clear that the provisions are applicable only in case of remittances which are made under the LRS, and only individuals are governed by the LRS. So partnership forms, etc., or companies which approach authorized dealers for these kind of remittances, there would be no TCS. All right, that was what I had to clear here. Now, because we are on this point, let us talk of over-the-counter foreign currency sale. So there are different views. I would not like to take much time on this, but there are different views whether a sale of foreign currency over the counter by authorized dealers would constitute as remittance or not. So remittance typically involves payment from one bank account to another bank account. If you look at the meaning of the term, which is, to my surprise, not defined either in the Income Tax Act for the purpose of this subsection, and it is neither being defined under the FEMA anyway, that to my knowledge. So then, in my view here is that if I'm an authorized dealer handing out foreign currency over the counter, so this is going to affect us as consumers, okay? Tomorrow, if I decide to travel abroad and I approach some authorized dealer for some hard cash, you know, for meeting my expenses when on travel abroad, to my mind, that 5% extra which I would otherwise be paying if it was a remittance would not apply, because this is a over-the-counter sale and it certainly, to my mind, does not qualify as remittance. However, looking at the substance of the provisions and the intentions with which they came into the statute, there could be a very strong contrary view possible. So until and unless, you know, we have some clarification, it's better to adopt a conservative view and budget for that 5% extra as consumers. And the authorized dealer should probably think of collecting TCS even whereas this kind of over the sale foreign currency is concerned, right? So these were the points which I had to discuss for 206C1G. Now, let us move on to the most awaited subsection for the evening, which is 206C1H. Now, there are a plethora of issues, I understand. Most of them have been deliberated at various forums. There are so many articles, everything has actually come out, but still, it is very interesting to cover them each time, because every time we revisit them, there are some new nuances which come forward. So my flow here is going to be that we are first going to talk about the bare provisions, because they have so much of an impact and that will help us get a clearer perspective when we are looking at the issues which come up. So after looking at the bare provisions, we are going to take up few immediate issues. Then there are certain scenarios again which I have put up. Then there are again some issues. And then we would, I think that would take about an hour or so. And then we would open up for question answers. Right? Just give me a minute. Coming to 206C1H, right? this particular section, when it came as a part of the Finance Bill 2020, it raised many eyebrows. You know, why, what is the need of this particular section? And, you know, once we are done with discussing the provisions and few of the issues, I would put forth some points which would again, you know, kind of question the very necessity of this provision as such. But before that, without any prejudice and any preconceived notions, let us respect the law and look at the bare section. So this section states that every person who is a seller who receives any amount as consideration for sale of any goods of the value or aggregate of such value exceeding 50 lakh rupees in any previous year, other than goods being exported out of India, or goods which are covered in subsection 1 or 1F or 1G, shall, at the time of receipt of such amount, collect from the buyer a sum equal to 0.1% of the sale consideration exceeding 50 lakh rupees as income tax. Right? Again, that rate reduction, I'm not repeating here. The rate would go down by that 25% logic again. But if you just look at these bare provisions, the entire emphasis is wherein the person who is a seller who receives any amount as consideration for sale. So the term receives is also important. The term consideration for sale is also important. For what? For sale of any goods. And again, they say that at the time of receipt of such amount, collect from the buyer a sum equal to 0.1%, etc., etc. So this is the bare provision which we have. Understanding it further. So it makes certain exclusions. So receipts from sale of scrap, alcoholic liquor, motor car, remittances under LRS, and that sale of tour package program, etc., are outside the purview of subsection 1H because they are abundantly covered under other subsections of this particular section. Correct? Not applicable, wherein the buyer is liable to make TDS at source from the amount payable to the seller and such tax has been deducted. So if there is such a transaction wherein the buyer, being the payer of this consideration, is already governed by maybe 194C, that's the most likely section which comes into here, then there is no requirement to apply the TCS provisions. Also, goods which are exported out of India have been excluded. There are certain entities which are again excluded from the definition of the term buyer. They would include state government, embassies, high commission, legations, etc., etc. Also, a local authority and person importing goods into India or other notified person. Presently, nothing else has been notified. Right? So, this was the provision. Now, we go to the first proviso, which talks of a very normal thing which we are aware of. If the buyer has not provided his PAN or Aadhaar number to the seller, then as per 206cc, instead of 0.1%, which is the rate of TCS here, TCS would happen at 1%. So 206cc otherwise has the higher rate stated at 5%, but for the purpose of this subsection, we are going to read that 5% as 1%. Correct? So if I don't furnish my PAN or Aadhaar, my rate of TCS would be 1% other than the 0.1% which I'm usually liable to. And then we discuss this proviso. We also discuss this implication that contracts which are covered by TDS, there is no TCS applicable. Okay. Now let us look at the meaning of the term seller in the context of this particular subsection. Now, seller here means a person whose gross receipts or turnover from the business carried on by him exceeds 10 crores during the financial year immediately preceding the financial year in which the sale of goods is carried out, and is not the exclusions which are there, which are to be or which can be notified. So, just ignoring the later part of the definition, seller here is going to mean a person whose total sales, gross receipts or turnover are in excess of 10 crores in the immediately preceding financial year. So that is the trigger point for the applicability of these TCS provisions. Quite a high level of threshold, I would say, though many assessees would be falling in its bracket, but this is the threshold they have specified. Then the next two subsections we can quickly run through. So in implementing these provisions, if there is any difficulty which arises, then certain guidelines can be made by the CBDT. And whatever guidelines are made, they would have to have the approval of both the houses of the parliament, and then only they would be binding on the income tax authorities and the assessees. So this is the entire range of amendment which is in the bare law. Right? Now the first and the most highlighting point over here is, this section is applicable in respect of sale of goods which are made by the seller. A common idea would have been to define what exactly is understood by the term goods in the first place. So to just kind of, make it clear at this point in time that the term goods has not been defined in the Income Tax Act, right? Not even in Section 2 and not even for the purpose of this particular section. So the first difficulty here is, what exactly do we understand by the term goods? Now, because it is not defined in the Income Tax Act, we move on to other near statutes which can help us with its understanding. So first and foremost, we look at Sale of Goods Act, which is a more specific statute dealing with the definition of goods, and the other could be GST Act. Now, the difference between both these acts which define goods is that, as far as Sale of Goods Act is concerned, shares and securities are included in the definition of goods. However, in GST Act, to my mind, shares and securities have been excluded. So then let us try and evaluate goods under this particular definition. Now let us look at this scenario here. So the first question here is whether shares and securities would come within the category of goods. So there would be two, three situations which we would need to analyze here. Now, as a dealer of shares and securities, correct? I could be dealing in listed shares and securities on which I would be paying STT. I would be dealing in unlisted shares and securities on which there would be no STT. Correct. Now, thankfully, the circular which came out on the 29th of September said that there were certain operational difficulties so far as to the implementation of TCS provisions in case of listed shares and securities are concerned, and therefore listed shares and securities are excluded from the terminology of goods for the purpose of levy of TCS. So that settles one point and unsettles the other. So if they have specifically excluded listed shares and securities by virtue of operational difficulties, does it imply that unlisted shares and securities would still form a part and parcel for the purpose of levy of TCS? Now, let us try and understand this scenario in a more practical approach. When I talk of unlisted shares or securities, correct, they would typically be shares of private companies which are unlisted and which are not routinely traded, right? The first criteria for being goods is it has to be something which is marketable, which is openly traded in the market. Now, typically, shares of private limited companies would not fulfill that criteria, and therefore, it would be still difficult to kind of have a view that they fall in the definition of goods. So to my mind, again, when I'm a dealer of shares and securities, listed shares, they came out with a clarification which implies that unlisted shares are still goods. But how would this provision be applicable in that case remains to be seen. Correct? That is for dealer. Now let us look at a scenario where I'm an investor of shares and securities and I sell certain listed shares and securities. Okay, so I have some stocks which I have invested in, and the sale which I make in a particular previous year might exceed 50 lakh rupees, which is the threshold criteria given out by this section. But when I'm an investor, the question which comes up here is whether this amount which I am earning on account of sale of these kind of securities, does it form a part of my turnover or gross receipts? Because when I made you go through the definition of seller, and it is always my habit to go through the bare provisions before we analyze it, we saw that for the trigger of this section to come into picture, the seller in the immediately preceding financial year has to have a gross receipt or turnover which is in excess of 10 crores, correct? So whether these receipts from these kind of sale of shares or assets which I hold as my investment qualify as my turnover is the first question. And secondly, since they are being held as my investments, they would by no stretch of imagination be called as my goods, right? That is the view I have. And therefore, if they are shares and securities which are held by an investor, they should be excluded from the levy of TCS. Contrary views could exist, but this is my view, right? Moving further, what would be the scenario if other assets are sold? Right. So supposing Mr. A deals in some typical kind of goods and he makes a sale to a party, Mr. B, during the previous year. His sale in the immediately preceding previous year is more than 10 crores. And current year, he sold, let us say, some 60 lakh odd worth goods to Mr. B. Now, Mr. B has come across some furniture or some machinery or some other asset of Mr. A, which he is also interested in buying. Mr. A doesn't usually deal in these kind of goods, but as a one of a case, he sells it off. Correct? Whether TCS would be collected on this sale of machinery or furniture or other capital asset made by Mr. A to Mr. B is the second question which comes into picture. Now again, here, like as is the case for every single aspect of the issues coming out of this section, most of us are going to have contrary views. But I would like to draw your attention to the fact that this particular section 206C is situated under chapter 17B, and that part of the chapter where this is situated reads as profits and gains from the business of trading in. Correct? So the receipts which I'm talking of in the context of this levy of TCS have to be restricted to my trading receipts. And when I don't typically deal in any kind of machinery or furniture as a part of my usual business activities, there would be no levy of TCS for the purpose of sale of that machinery or furniture which I have effected, even though all my other conditions with respect to threshold have been complied with. So they are not goods to me, right? My goods are my stock in trade, which I usually deal in. That is the view I hold. There could be contrary views. This is about the meaning of the term goods and the points which came to my mind. There are also few points which I have covered going further, like what would be the scenario in case of software, etc. But the issues I have just kind of lined up in the order of, you know, the frequency at which they come up to our minds. So the next important part which comes here is, and the circular said that it clarified this, is when I talk of consideration, whether I have to collect TCS on such part of consideration which is inclusive of GST or exclusive of GST. So the typical question which gets raised here is whether GST is to be covered as a part of my consideration or not. Now, there are different views on this as well, correct? There are certain judicial precedents from old Supreme Court decision is also there in this context, which say that when we talk of the term consideration, it is inclusive of all the indirect taxation levies which come along with it. And therefore, the amount of GST would certainly be a part of consideration. And therefore, TCS should be deducted on the amount of consideration inclusive of the GST component. This is one view which comes up. Then there was the CBDT circular, you know, which was in the context of TDS, which I would right now not bring in because we already have that circular number 20, circular dated 29 September, which came in. So that particular circular, what it says, we are going to discuss in the next slide. But basis judicial precedents, there is a popular view that GST does form a part and parcel of the term consideration, and therefore TCS should be made inclusive of GST. At this point, I would also like to make a reference to the method of accounting which is employed by a particular SSC. So it could be the inclusive method or the exclusive method, and that also could provide certain pointers as to whether GST has to be included or not. The next question here is, whether the TCS component should form a part and parcel for the purpose of GST. So I have my value, then there is this component of TCS, and then there is this requirement of charging GST. So in this situation, there is an old CBIC circular which has clarified that TCS is an interim levy, and therefore it is nothing, it has got nothing to do with the term supply, right? And therefore there should be no levy of GST as far as the TCS component is concerned. So I believe on this aspect we are clear, right? All of us are aware that there are twofold aspects. The first aspect, whether TCS should be done on GST, there are contrary views. Whether GST should be done on TCS, we all are settled that it should not form a part and parcel of the component for levy of GST basis this circular, which I have put up in this slide, the reference number, right? Going further, now I would like to draw your attention to certain important points pre and post circular, which I would like to bring to your notice. See, the reason we went through the section is right throughout the wordings of the section, the term which is being used is receipt of consideration. Correct? Amount or the receipts on account of sale, right? These are equally used. So what were the issues, whether TCS provisions would apply to sales which took place prior to 1st October 2020? What would be the status of advances for sales effected later? And what would be the status of that money which is received prior to 1st October 2020 for the purpose of reckoning the threshold? Now, all this I have covered here in a tabulated form, and I have two columns here because this was my analysis prior to the circular coming in, and this is my analysis after the circular comes in, and as you can see, little matches in that. So let us have a quick discussion about this. Right, the first table or the first way in which I have bifurcated this is with regards to applicability of TCS. In terms of sale or receipt, there are different scenarios I have put up over here. My date of sale is in the financial year 1920. My date of receipt is in the financial year 2021. Before the circular came in, the view was that it would not cover sales which were made prior to 1st October 2020 because the section is prospective in its application. So any sale which took place in the financial year 1920 would not be covered by the applicability of TCS provisions. The circular which came in on 29 September proved otherwise, and it had a statement which said that even sales which are effected prior to that, if the consideration is received on or after 1st October 2020, TCS provisions would be applicable. So I'm just discussing the scenarios pre and post circular, and then I'll tell you what my views are. The date of sale is financial year 2021. On or after 1st October 2020, correct? The date of receipt is also in the financial year 2021, on or after 1st of October 2020. Before the circular came in and after the circular also, nothing changes as far as this is concerned because it's a pretty straightforward scenario. My sale has taken place after the section coming into picture. The receipt of my consideration is also after the section has come into picture, and therefore the TCS provisions will be applicable, irrespective of the circular. Talking of the third scenario, the date of sale is in financial year 2021 and it is prior to 1st October 2020. So my sale has been effected prior to 1st October 2020. My date of receipt is in the financial year 2021 on or after 1st October 2020. Prior to the circular coming in, I was of the view that TCS would not be applicable because it is a prospective section. It would not typically cover a sale which takes place prior to 1st October 2020. After the circular, because of the language which is used in the circular, it is apparent that it would cover sales which are made prior to 1st October 2020 as well when the consideration is received on or after 1st October 2020. So after the circular, the view falls is that it is going to be applicable. Coming to the second last scenario, which is put up on the slide, the date of sale is in financial year 2021 before the 1st of October. The date of receipt is financial year 1920. So typically, this was an advance which was received in the earlier financial year, against which sales have been made in the current financial year prior to 1st October. Before and after the circular, the view remains the same, that TCS provisions are not applicable, because even though it was an advance, it got converted into sale prior to 1st October. Right? So that is the view I have taken here, that the TCS provisions would not come into picture, because the receipt of consideration, as per the language which is being used in the circular, is before 1st October 2020. Coming to the last scenario, my date of sale is in financial year 2021 after the 1st of October 2020, correct? And my date of receipt is in financial year 1920. TCS provisions would be applicable, because the amount which I received in 1920 was classified as an advance in that year, which took the character of sale consideration in current year, and that also after 1st October 2020. That was the view I held pre-circular. After the circular comes into picture, what happens? Though the sale, it transformed into a sale after 1st October 2020, the consideration was received in the earlier financial year, and the circular is very explicit in its usage of words that only such consideration which is received on or after 1st of October 2020 would be affected by the TCS provisions, and therefore the TCS provisions will not be applicable. Right? So this is the view post-circular, that for the last scenario, it would not be applicable. So like you can see, it is all before you, before and after, what views I had interpreted in basis section are like turned opposite after reading the wordings which are given out in the circular. Now let me just highlight few things here before I place my views before you. We all have been through the bare section before I started this discussion. All right. The section constantly uses the word receipt on account of sale consideration. Its emphasis is all throughout on the term received and sale consideration. If you look at the circular is very, very constant in its usage of terms, that everything is linked to the date of receipt of consideration. So as to say that if any sale has happened last year, last to last year, but I receive the money in the present year on or after 1st of October, I would still be governed by TCS provisions, because the trigger for TCS provisions is the receipt of consideration. That is the ideology which the circular puts forth. Now, I beg to differ in my humble view in few of the aspects which the circular has come out with. First of all, I still hold my view that the section is prospective in its application, because it has come into effect from the 1st of October 2020, and therefore it has no locus standi to cover those sales took place prior to 1st October 2020. Therefore, even if the consideration in respect of such sales is received on or after 1st October 2020, to my mind, it would still be wrong to apply the TCS provision those kind of receipts for which sales took place to the onset of this section. That is the first view. Correct? Second is with respect to the status of advances. Now, to our disadvantage, the term Alpesh, is my voice clear?
Yes, perfect.
Okay, I just got an unstable connection warning. So if it happens again, I'll just put off my video, okay?
It's okay.
Yeah, fine. So next is with respect to status of advances. Now, if you look at the entire section, nowhere have they made a reference to the term advances. They have constantly been speaking of either receipts or sale consideration. Now, to our disadvantage, the term consideration or sale consideration has not been defined for the purpose of this subsection. So we have to understand it in the usual sense of the term. So something qualifies to be a sale consideration to me only when it is in lieu of a sale which has been effected. Something which is in the nature of advance is just that. It is an advance. I cannot say that what is in nature of advance part takes the character of consideration. So something which was an advance in financial year 1920, if I make the sale against that advance in financial year 2021, that amount which was advanced will become sale consideration to me in the financial year 2021 when the sale took place, right? In the earlier year, it's going to remain as an advance only. So to my mind, even if there is any advances which you have received, it would not be covered by the applicability of TCS, right? Despite the circular. Now, these views are my humble views. Of course, the language of the circular states something else, but I just go by one logic, which I have always been trained to believe in, that some particular word which is not there in the bare provision of law, any circular cannot kind of import that word into the section. So the section is not prospective. The circular cannot make it cover sales, the section is prospective. The circular cannot make it cover sales prior to 1st October. The circular cannot bring into TCS on advances. However, that is my view. If we look at the practical scenario and have a larger vision, assessees whose sales in the preceding previous year are in excess of 10 crores and where they are dealing with a single party sale in excess of 50 lakhs, 0.1% of that amount, which is in excess of 50 lakhs, would really not be a material amount as far as these assessees are concerned. And therefore, a businessman, so if I had been a businessman rather than a tax person, I would have always decided that let's pay off the amount or let's collect it and just let's not get into any administrative hassles with the department. So practical view which one may take would be that we can adhere to the circular the way it is and, you know, try and collect TCS in respect of all such amounts which we receive on or after 1st October 2020, even if they pertain to sales which were made earlier. Correct? Or we start taking TCS even in respect of advances which are received post this date, given the fact that the sales are to happen at a different date. Correct? So this is the contrast of my view before the circular and what the circular brings in. I hope these scenarios put to rest majority of questions which immediately come to our mind when we look at the provisions. So this is what I have to say in so far as applicability of TCS for sale is concerned. All right, sale and receipt. Moving on to the next scenarios which I've put forth here is that is with regards to the threshold criteria. Correct. So how do we determine 50 lakhs? Now here the circular seems to give out a view which is in line with the section per se, unlike the earlier situation. Because here the wordings which are used by the section say that the aggregate amounts of sale consideration for a previous year are in excess of 50 lakhs. So they're talking of the entire previous year. And that is the view which the circular kind of emphasizes, that the consideration for the entire year has to be seen to determine the threshold of 50 lakhs. So here in the first case, the sale was effected in financial year 2021 of 70 lakhs post 1st October 2020. 30 lakhs was received pre-October 2020 and balance, that is INR 40 lakhs, was received post-October 2020. Now, before or after circular, TCS provisions are applicable because sale bhi 1st October ke baad hai, receipt bhi uske baad hai. TCS year will be done on the consideration of 20 lakhs. Threshold applicability will be for the entire year. So 70 lakhs I would be reducing by 50 lakhs and balance 20 lakhs I would be making the TCS. Second, I'll be quickly running through this because I am really keen on taking up questions from your side as well. And this is, I believe, now the first table helped us visualize this situation in detail. That is my understanding of the situation. So secondly, sales are effected in financial year 2021, 55 lakhs pre-October 2020. INR 20 lakhs was received before 1st October 2020. Balance INR 35 lakhs was received post-October 2020. Now, before the circular, TCS was not applicable in my mind. After the circular, TCS becomes applicable because it has to consider all the receipts even for sales which are made prior to October 2020. And therefore, TCS will be made on 5 lakhs, which is the difference between 55 minus the threshold of 50 lakhs. Extending this scenario to further, suppose sales effected further in the year with the same party are 40 lakhs. Correct? whether the earlier consideration of 55 lakhs, which is received pre, you know, 1st October, has to be considered for the purpose of threshold. So yes, aggregate amounts you have to consider in this case. So 55 plus 40 would be 95, and from that you would reduce 50, and TCS would have to be made on the balance amount. So this is an analytical table which discusses about the threshold applicability. Now let us go and discuss certain issues. And yes, in good time, I think by 7:20 we should be able to look at the questions. All right? Okay. Now first is with regards to sales return. What is the available recourse? Now I have covered it in the next slide when we talk about the circular implications. So I would for the purpose just ignore it in this slide. All right. Also discounts, freebies and variation in prices gets covered in the next slide. Moving on to the third point on the slide, which talks of export of goods outside India, correct? Excluded from the applicability of TCS. Now, when I'm determining the threshold of INR 10 crores in the preceding previous year, I am required to include these exports for the purpose of determining that 10 crore criteria. Okay, but when I am determining the threshold criteria for 50 lakhs in the current year to ensure the applicability of TCS provisions, goods which are exported out of India will be excluded. So I hope I'm clear when I say this. So all exports have to be considered as a part of my turnover for the purpose of determining 10 crore criteria. But when it comes to current year's determination of 50 lakhs threshold, I would have to exclude goods which are exported out of India. Next question which would come up here is, supposing certain goods are sold to export-oriented units or units which are located in the special economic zones, whether the TCS provisions would be applicable. Now, as we all know, these units which are located in here, any kind of transactions entered into with them are considered as export transactions, correct? But if we look at the wordings of Section 206(c)(1)(h), they categorically mention that goods which are exported out of India are to be excluded. So these kind of exports which are made to these entities which have been given the status of export-oriented units or SEZs, etc., would still be covered by the TCS provisions, as is my view. Right? So these were two points with regards to the export aspect. Coming to the third, that's the last point on the slide, and the third point which we take up, whether the provisions of 206(c)(1)(h) cover the sale of software. Now, members, this is a very tricky question, whether it would be applicable as far as software sale is concerned. And this is because, you know, the nature of transaction by which this software is sold has to be first evaluated. Now, if it just involves the downloading of a particular software on account of a license or a pass key, which is made available to the buyer, then to my mind, the only aspect involved there is an intangible one, and maybe therefore the provisions of TCS should not be made applicable. However, there is an equally popular view, and I believe which is also the view in under GST, which one adheres to. I am not conversant to a great extent with GST, but under GST, wherein so there are sale of softwares by way of certain, CDs or whatever other mechanisms, it is treated as goods to my mind. So I believe if it's just an intangible transfer involving some download or some passkey or some access to a particular software located on a website or something, it should usually not amount to goods. However, there is a gray area, and because the other revenue, the other levy which we have, GST, considers it to be something on which GST is leviable in certain circumstances, I believe it is something which will differ from case to case, and whether it will be covered by the levy of TCS will determine upon the nature of transaction under which it is sold. So that is the view I have in this case. Okay. Now these are the circular implications, you know. So this particular circular came in well after I had made this content for TCS, and therefore I just decided to put an extra slide as to what were the implications arising out of this circular. So first and foremost, like we discussed, transactions in shares, also they have covered commodities, which are traded through a recognized stock exchange, are excluded from the application of Section 206C1H. So like I discussed in the earlier chart when I was talking of goods, this specific exclusion will probably lead to an implied meaning that unlisted shares and securities or shares in commodities which are traded otherwise than through a recognized stock exchange could be included in the meaning of the term goods for the purpose of applicability of 206C1H. However, when I was deliberating upon that slide, I gave you my views as to why the same should be excluded from the meaning of the term goods. The second issue is sorted, and I believe we have a majority consensus as far as this is concerned, that the threshold criteria of INR 50 lakhs with regards to the receipt of sale consideration has to be seen for the entire year beginning from 1st April, including the period prior to the section coming into force. Third is TCS, whether it is applicable to sale consideration received before 1st October 2020. So the circular is very adamant in its usage of the term receipts on or after 1st October 2020, and therefore it would not cover such consideration which is received prior to 1st October 2020. And as a corollary of which, it would apply to all such consideration received on or after 1st October 2020, even if the sale was carried out prior to 1st October 2020. Now, friends, on this also, in the table which I was discussing, I gave you the views pre-circular, post-circular, and I also deliberated upon what were my personal views in this regard. So I wouldn't repeat these two points again. Let us move on to the next set of issues that we have. Okay. Now, this is somewhere wherein a practical aspect comes in. Just excuse me. A lot of queries and questions have come up as to what is a good way of presenting this TCS, whether it is to be included in the invoice or whether it is to be sent out separately as a debit note once the threshold criteria of that 50 lakh per party, etc. is crossed. Now, to my mind, there is no singular way of commenting on what is a good way to do it or not a good way to do it. I think we should leave it to the discretion of the client. So if the client has proper systems in place, accounting softwares, which can be suitably modified, so then a better way would be that in the invoice, you write about the invoice value, then add in a column for the GST component, whatever applicable rates, and then include the TCS component for the 0.01 or whatever 0.075%, and then the aggregate value can be reached at. That is one way of doing it. Secondly, you can just continue to not include it till such point in time that the 50 lakh threshold is met. And once that is that criteria or that threshold is surpassed, you can just send a debit note and collect that kind of amount from the buyer. Okay, that is one thing. Now, since we are on the topic of invoice, and because the circular so categorically states that TCS is going to be applicable even in case of consideration which is received on or after 1st October involving sales which were made pre-October. So here we would have certain practical difficulties to my mind. First is, when the original sale invoice might have been raised, correct? It would certainly not incorporate the element of TCS, because at that point in time, TCS was not a levy which we were aware of. So we have already raised that invoice, it's been sent to the buyer. The buyer is yet to pay us for that invoice. Assuming he pays on or after 1st October 2020, we would have to make an additional additional recovery to him in respect of the amount of TCS, because we are ideally supposed to collect it from the buyer and then deposit it to the credit of the government. Now, practically, buyers may not agree to paying this kind of TCS because it pertains to a sale which has already taken effect. So that might be one difficulty which we would face. Secondly, if there is a running account which we have, you know, and we are not very keen or particular in respect of segregating or having cutoffs for transactions year on year basis, then it would be a very t- tough task to sort of reconcile as to what receipts, at what point in time was the threshold of 50 lakhs met, what consideration received pertains to which invoice. So those are few practical difficulties which are likely to come up because of the fact that sales which have been effected earlier for which amounts are outstanding and will be received on or after 1st October are to be covered under the ambit of TCS. So these are a few practical difficulties and we all have to kind of have a word with the client and arrive at a mutually beneficial way for them as well as for the buyers involved in this situation. So this is what I would have to say about the invoice aspect and the applicability to outstanding amounts which are received on or after 1st October. Secondly, this TCS, which is there, you know, it has to be paid with reference to the point in time when the invoice for sale was raised or with respect to receipt of consideration. So just to simplify our discussion for the time being, let us assume that I raise a particular invoice on, say, in the month of November, wherein I include this TCS, okay? And the invoice is sent to the buyer. He makes the payment in the month of January. So whether I as a seller have to pay off this TCS to the credit of the government in the month of November itself because I raised the invoice for sale in that month or whether I should wait till I actually receive the consideration. Now here the sentiment which is echoed throughout the section is linked to receipt of consideration. And therefore the view which I would have in this particular situation would be that the TCS has to be paid within the prescribed time having reference to the date of receipt of consideration and not with respect to raising of the invoice. And again here there might be certain sellers who might not be so would not like to go through the hassle to wait and to calculate that 50 lakh threshold being crossed etc. and they would start including this TCS component right away in their sales invoices. In that case, I believe they would have to do a reconciliation, wait for that amount to be collected and then pay off the TCS. That is the view I have because the section typically relates every event to receipt of consideration. The third issue here is the meaning of the term turnover or consideration as is being used is not defined. So this brings us back to that question, you know, whether GST has to be included or excluded. And I'm not just from the viewpoint of levy of TCS. I'm also coming from the viewpoint of ascertaining what is turnover for the purpose of that applicability or trigger, you know. So when I'm determining my turnover for the immediately preceding previous year, am I to look at the turnover including the GST component or am I to look at it excluding the GST component? So here my view would be it has a direct nexus with the method of accounting that you are following. And in most cases, if it is the inclusive method, you would have to include the GST component in determining your threshold criteria for turnover. Right. So these were a few normal points which come to our mind. Now an in-depth reading of the provision put up another small point in my head which I have not been able to deliberate upon as such in a greater detail. So you see the bare section uses the term value, right? It uses the term receipt of sale consideration of the value or aggregate value of the goods sold in the particular previous year. So whether there is any typical meaning of the term value or it is just been loosely used, that is also one aspect which needs to be thought of. So, okay, moving on. I think the first point we have covered, TCS would not be applicable where TDS is applicable. Again, sales made to public sector companies which are wholly owned by state and central government would be covered because what is excluded from the definition of buyer is only the state and central government and not public sector entities. Next issue I would take up here is suppose there are multiple entities to which sale is being made, right, of the same buyer, which have different TAN numbers for the purpose of their TDS compliances. So this TCS liability has to be ascertained PAN-wise or TAN-wise. And my answer here would be, of course, it has to be considered PAN-wise because ultimately that is how the consolidation for the purpose of their ITR is to take place and the different TANs are just to facilitate their respective compliances. Next issue here would be whether transportation and freight charges which are recovered from the buyer, are they to form a part of consideration or no? Now again, here, you know, this would put forward a practical difficulty if it is mind. Voice covers it, then there would be some kind of debate possible, but a logical answer here would be any reimbursements or any recoveries which are made on account of transportation and freight charges would not form a part of consideration for the purpose of collecting TCS. This brings me to a very interesting aspect here. Okay, so when there were these several representations which were made by various forums to the government to carve out B2B transactions separately from the applicability of TCS. Now, what was the reasoning behind this? See, let us go back to history and see the section 2011A, which was the original section. 2011, I mean to say. Now, we have a subsection there, 1A, which says that if there is a buyer who is acquiring goods for further manufacturing or processing. So those specific goods which are given in that schedule, if they are obtained for the purpose of further manufacturing or processing, and the buyer gives a declaration and or to this effect, in that case, TCS is not required to be made. So the original provisions of TCS under section 201 give a specific carve out in respect of B2B transactions is what I would say. A similar exclusion is absent so far as section 206C1H is concerned. So my consumer, so my buyer here could be the end consumer, or he could be another person who's going to use those goods for further manufacturing or processing purposes. Still, the sale would be liable for TCS because there is no separate carve-out for B2B transactions. So this is one small distinction I would like to bring to your notice. Ideally, there should have had been an exclusion because it is just... you're just adding up to the administrative hassles and the various levies which are going to form a part of that value of goods going further. So if I'm using those goods for further manufacturing purposes, they should have ideally been excluded from the levy of TCS, but that doesn't seem to be the intention. Also, the criteria with respect to trigger of this section links that the seller in the earlier year has to have a turnover in excess of 10 crores. Now, if it is the first year of incorporation of a particular entity or the first year of operations of a particular business, how would I evaluate this criteria? Because there is nothing which has been specified and I would have no previous record when it comes to the earlier year and the turnover in that particular year. So whether I have to look at the turnover in total for the year in consideration, or I have to make a blanket assumption that I am not covered by TCS provisions because I don't fulfill the trigger criteria. Some kind of clarity on this would be appreciated from the department's side. Another point here is, unlike the other TDS sections which we are aware of, there is no mechanism for any application which the buyer can make for a lower rate or a nil rate of TCS. Now, a lower rate would be kind of a joke here because the rate is already so low. But then they could certainly incorporate some mechanism wherein a buyer could apply for nil rate certificate, because if there are buyers who are incurring perennial losses, then this collection of TCS additionally would add to their burden in terms of blocking of funds is concerned. Moving on, let us look at a few practical aspects. This TCS has to be paid to the credit of the government by the 7th of subsequent month. The seller has to have valid TAN. He has to furnish his TCS return in form 27EQ on a quarterly basis. After these sections were brought into the statutes, the rules relating to TCS and TDS returns were also amended. So I have taken up it in the next slide. So you're under 27EQ. You're required to give a party-wise breakup in the form from whom you have collected TCS. And the amendments in these rules are to this effect, that you have to now include particulars of amount on which TCS was not made. So the rule says on such amounts on which TCS was not collected. So there was initially a confusion whether TCS was collectible and not collected, or TCS merely was not collected. So it highlights that only under these two provisos where it was not collectible. So firstly, wherein TDS provisions are applicable and that's why we did not collect TCS, I'm required to give particulars of these instances in my form 27EQ. And the second detail which I have to give is where my buyer is an entity who is specifically excluded from the applicability of these transactions. So if I have not collected TCS because of these two reasons, I have to include total particulars of that in my TCS return, which is 27EQ. And the due dates for compliance with TCS returns are as follows. So for the quarter April to June, it is 15 July, then July to September, it's 15th October. October to December, it is 15 Jan, and Jan to March, it is 15th of May. So this is, I have included the word normally because we are in a season where everything is getting extended. So I don't know what the fate for these filing these statements would be in the days to come. Now here, I would like to close my part of the discussion and with a few things. You know, like I said, when I began this discussion on TCS, I questioned the necessity of these provisions coming into statute. All right. So let me just bring out few facts, which I'm sure all of you would be aware. First and foremost, we are looking at huge assessees here required to comply with the TCS provisions, whose turnover is in excess of 10 crores, sale to a single party is in excess of 50 lakhs. So I'm sure there would be several other compliance requirements which these assessees would be duly complying with to save themselves from various penal provisions under the Income Tax Act. Secondly, as I am aware and as I have been told and I have read that under the GST regime, if there is your sales and purchases are in excess of 40 lakhs, you need to get yourself registered. And once you are registered, all the details of your transactions are available on the system. So when we are in an era wherein the Income Tax Department and its sister departments has so many SSE related data at its disposal on the basis of a single PAN or a TAN or a GST number, it is very difficult to fathom that how would one SSE of this nature exclude or evade taxes, and that is being given out as the rationale for introducing these provisions. So that is a mystery and it is quite amusing, but I would like to leave it at that. And this kind of brings me to the end of what I had to share with all of you today. Before I go to the questions, I hope I was lucid enough. And though I am not able to view all of your faces to get an hang whether I have managed to do my job well, I would just leave that to assumption. And we would look at a few questions which have come up in the chat box. We can go ahead, Alpesh bhai.
Yes, yeah. Prachi. Prachi, coming to my mind, sharing a screen with you.
Okay, I'll stop my sharing. Yeah.
Diksha, just share the screen.
Yes. Alpesh bhai, only 2 minutes. Last two questions which has been raised now. I'm just compiling only those two questions. Huh? Two minutes. Yes, yes.
Before taking the question, I request Sneha to be for the speakers today.
Alpesh bhai, I am not able to hear what you said.
Before taking up the question answers, I just request Sneha Varaya to take the vote of thanks for the today's speaker.
Okay.
Thank you, Alpesh bhai. It's my privilege to give the formal BOT for CA Prachi Parekh. Friends, learning gives us creativity and creative leads us to thinking. Thinking provides knowledge and knowledge makes us great. Members, we all are united by a common mission of learning. Friends, you all will agree, CA Prachi Parekh covered her presentation with relevant examples in simple and lucid language. We are thankful to her for accepting our invitation and sharing her rich knowledge on the subject. I, on behalf of Mulund CACP Study Circle, present heartily vote of thanks. We are also thankful to each and every participant for joining via webinar. Over to Alpesh bhai.
Thank you, Sneha. Diksha, can you just share the
Yes.
Prachi, you can just go through one by one all questions, and if thereafter, if any additional is there, that also we'll compile and share on the screen.
Sure, no worries.
Can you see the screen?
Yeah, can you just zoom in a little?
Still zoom? Yeah, okay. Wait.
Make it smaller. Because no, slightly bigger.
Yeah. Tell me.
This is fine.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm taking up the questions in the order in which they are appearing here, and I believe all the participants are also able to view the screen. So the first question is, what happens if a resort is registered with more than one operator and booking is done directly by the tourist from the resort? Who will deduct tax? So I believe this is in the context of 194O is what I understand. So there is a particular resort which is registered with more than one operator. So in this case, even if the booking is done directly by the tourist, he would have used the operator as the medium to find the resort. And because the section is so worded that the amount which the tourist pays directly to the resort is also going to be deemed to have been paid by that operator to the resort, right? So suppose there is this resort which is registered on both Make My Trip and any other platform, maybe Go Ibigo or whatever. So I, as a tourist, would have used either of these to make my payment, and I believe that tracking would be available. So the operator through whom the tourist got the linkage of that resort would have to consider it as his gross sales. I mean, that is what I understand out of the question. Okay, moving on. Whether an equalization levy, it will be need to be grossed up. So, see, as far as equalization levy and how it's going to operate is concerned, we all need to wait and watch, because a lot of representations have been made by the non-resident e-commerce operators for reconsidering the levy of 2% by the government. So I'm not very sure practically how it will work, but the way things are right now, 2% levy will have to be paid irrespective of the TDS which these people are done on the amount which they are to going to pay, which on the amount which is to be collected by targeting the Indian websites or advertisements in India. That seems to be the idea. Chartered accounting services can be treated as technical services. To my mind, no, they would be treated as professional services. ICAI should try to reduce the TDS amount for CA services, which is a mix of both commercial and technical services. I would say it is more of a professional services, not typically the technical services. But yes, I do agree that the amount of TDS can certainly be reduced. We can give it a try. The fourth question, 194C related query. Okay, Mr. A is purchasing raw material from Mr. B, manufactures products as per Mr. B's specifications, and sells the finished goods to Mr. B. Both are not related party. Mr. B deducts TDS on the net amount of the total bills raised by Mr. A. Whether Mr. A is required to deduct TDS on bills raised by Mr. B, that is the first transaction of raw material. So in the first transaction, Mr. A is just purchasing goods, right? So there would not be a question of TDS in this case. Of course, 206C1H, which we just now deliberated, can be thought of, but because it is part of a transaction, which is kind of, I would say, an intermediary for 194C, it needs to be evaluated whether 206C1H would come. As far as deduction of TDS is concerned, it would not come because Mr. A is just purchasing the material from Mr. B. Okay. In case where there is both sale and purchase transaction with the same party and net amount received or paid, then how TCS will be applicable? Gross or net? Okay, so see, I would just like to mention one thing, and this brings me to a point which I kind of skipped when I discussed the slide. So first point here is that if you look at the circular which has come in, it says the consideration amount which has been received has to be the basis for TCS. So if there is any discount or if there is any price variation which was adjusted in the invoice on account of which I'm receiving lower consideration, then my TCS has to be on the lower consideration. But if I'm receiving the entire amount of consideration and later on any adjustment is made on account of any discount or, you know, as this question has been raised here for that mutual settlement, that would then not come under the TCS ambit. So TCS, to my mind, has to be linked totally with the receipt component. So this kind of adjustment which I make when I'm supposed to pay and I'm supposed to receive, that is not a part and parcel of my consideration. So I would have to make TCS on the sale consideration. Right. This is the answer to question number 5, which is put up here. Going further, I would like to say one more thing, which I skipped, and I would repeat it again. If there are any discounts or if there are any sales returns taking place and the consideration which I receive is net of these discounts or consideration, then my TCS has to be made only on such consideration. If I receive the gross consideration and later on I am adjusting on account of discounts or sales return, still, the gross amount will be liable for TCS and these adjustments will then later on be factored in. In this case, I'll tell you what happens. Suppose in the month of October, I make a sale. November, I make a sale. I put up my invoice and the buyer pays me right away. Okay, so let's say 70 lakhs was the amount of invoice. 20 lakhs pay I collected TCS and paid it to the credit of the government by 7th of December. Subsequently, as the buyer checks the goods for quality control, etc., it comes to his light that goods worth 5 lakhs of the consideration are defective or substandard, and he makes a sales return, which happens in the month of December. So here what has happened is the sales return has happened later, for which I'm going to adjust this consideration aspect later. So here I will be, I have already collected the TCS and paid. The only option buyer has is to claim refund of this TCS when his return is submitted. Now, suppose after factoring in the sales return, only the buyer makes payment to me. For example, he pays me in December and he pays me 5 lakhs less. Then I'm going to do TCS only on the amount which I received. So this, what I discussed now, has nothing to do with question number 5. I missed discussing this when we were on the slides, and that's why I thought I should put it across. Going on to question 6, GST amount to be included for 10 crores limit. I believe yes, if you're going by the inclusive method of accounting, which would be my answer to that question. Question number 7, NRI who has invested his funds in shares and bank deposits, etc. Now NRI desires to liquidate his investment and desires to remit the funds outside India. Does TCS provision be applicable? See, to my mind, this is not one of the aspects covered by the LRS. If anybody has any insights on that, they can correct me. But this is not what I have kind of thought to be covered under LRS. So there would be no TCS implication. Question number 8, how can we add TCS in the sales invoice? I think I've already taken this up when we discussed the slides. If buyer deducts TDS under 194C on net bill amount, excluding GST amount, then whether seller is required to collect TCS only on GST. So see, if there is already TDS happening on under 194C, then to my mind, TCS would not come into picture, but I'll read the question further. In another case, if sales bill shows material plus labor plus GST, and if buyer deducts income tax only on labor, then whether seller will be required to collect TCS on balance material amount. See, in this case, I would advise that you can probably have two separate invoices for the material component to avoid this entire kind of confusion. And yes, apparently it looks like what is not covered by TDS is still covered by TCS. So because a perfect bifurcation is possible in the question which has been put up here, I think on the material component, TCS could be leviable. Okay. TCS would be applicable on capital goods, fixed assets. I already covered it. NRI who's invested his funds in shares and bank deposits. Now NRI, I think it's come up already. I'm not sure this is under the LRS scheme, all right? So this could be outside the purview of TCS. TCS 206C1H is applicable in financial year 2021. Sales of March 21 outstanding on 31st March 21 and TCS was charged in the sale invoice. Now, if turnover in 2021 is below 10 crores, then what about the TCS which is collected from customer on outstanding of March 21? Also, if turnover in financial year 2021 was above 10 crores, but TCS was not payable on first receipt of 50 lakhs from each customer in 2021, then what about TCS amount which is collected from the customer on the outstanding of March 21? So, see, it is the receipt is linked to a sale which was made in 2021, and which year I am assuming that you have fulfilled the criteria for applicability of TCS. So this TCS which is collected by the seller already, he has to deposit it, to my mind, because it's already been collected. So later on in the next year, if that year the sales are below 10 crores, so 21-22, he would not be required to collect TCS. Okay. Since payments are made by the consumer directly to the e-commerce participant, how can the e-commerce operator deduct TDS of e-commerce participant, as the operator has nothing to pay to the participant from its side? Yeah, this is a very valid point. And that is one aspect why the rate is as low as 1%, I would say. So he has probably not received anything from the customer, but there might be some scheme of arrangements between the e-commerce and operators and participants, wherein there might be an exchange of funds. So there will be certain amounts which the e-commerce operator has to pay to the e-commerce participant. He has to first adjust this out of it. If not, he has to bear it as out of his own pockets, and later on have a mechanism in place to sort of collect it from adjust it with the participant. So this point was deliberated when this section came in under 194O in the bill, you know. But the lacuna here is that there is no live case which we have worked upon to understand how this mechanism between Zomato and a restaurant listed on Zomato works. So to our mind, reading the bare provisions, the e-commerce operator is under an obligation to pay that 1% of the gross sales anyhow, and then later on commercially it can be worked out between the two of them. Any other questions? I'll just look up the chat box now.
Prachi ma'am, now Balaji will share the screen. There are some more queries which he has compiled.
Sure.
These are the two questions.
Yeah, can you just scroll it up? I can't. This is the in case is from where the question begins.
Yeah, in case, yes, perfect.
So, in case of booking for tours is done by the tour operator and he has booked with the principal, then whether both the person, no. The fourth proviso is pretty clear. If the tour operator has done the TCS, then further the authorized agent is not going to do, the authorized dealer is not going to do TCS. Mr. A and Mr. B both purchase and sale to each other, but Mr. A lesser purchases, never makes payment to Mr. B. Only Mr. B more purchases, pays net amount to Mr. A. Then 2061H is applicable on the respective sale amount. See, I think earlier this question has come up. So I think adjustment by way of a JV is certainly not something by which the consideration amount will be reduced, to my mind. So whoever is fulfilling the applicability criteria for TCS provisions will have to collect the TCS as the seller and pay it to the credit of the government. This JV adjustment is not, to my mind, by which the amount of consideration can be reduced for the purpose of TCS, because it is in no way a part and parcel of the amount received on sale of consideration of goods.
Hello.
Yes, yes. Okay. I can't I'm seeing any more questions. Yeah.
No, that's it.
Yeah.
That's all for anything else you want to edit up?
No, I would just like to say a big thank you to all the participants for patiently putting up for the 2 hour 45 minute session that we had. And I honestly believe that people found it useful. It's really difficult to judge it in this Zoom platform.
You can just check it out that till now, 200 plus members are still there.
Yeah.
So it shows that the interest of yours.
Thank you
very much, Prachi.
Thank you so much.
Are you ends the meeting?
Yes.